Mr. Mayor?
Okay, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the December 3rd meeting of the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee. Tonight is a work session, but before we start, if everyone could please rise to budget.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, and so that our secretary, working remote, count on everybody here. We'll start with introductions totally around the table. Nick, as always, let's start in your corner.
Nick Bridle.
Scott Blair.
Mike Pierce.
Tom Kravitz.
Chuck Rage, representing the Hampton Village District.
Brian Lobham.
Eileen Latimer, Chair.
Stephen LeBranch.
Timothy Citizen Jones, representing the voters of Hampton.
Sandra Nicholson.
Mike Plouffe.
Jerry Zanar here.
Phil Bean, good evening.
Thank you.
Junior.
Will Kennedy.
Thank you, gentlemen. All right, a little bit of correspondence. I mean, we were just here not too long ago. There were some questions that went out to Chief Ayotte, and those answers are back. We'll take that up during the budget. And on a second note, some information from about the audit, that the audit is complete at this point. Actually, the main part of the audit, and maybe if I'm saying this wrong, Fred, maybe you can correct me. Main part of the audit was done a long time ago, but there was difficulty getting numbers for the capital assets because of the way it's in several different places, it's in several different programs. All the information was there, but the auditors had a difficult time retrieving it. I got that correct?
We had been compliant with GASB 34.
Right.
So in order to bring all of the fixed assets onto the books, it's a huge undertaking on the part of us in the finance department, along with all of the department heads who had to help get all of their infrastructure, their vehicles, and all of that onto the books. And then we ran into some software issues also. So that is what's the main holdup of the audit.
Is everyone on the same software for that, for listing that, or do we have different programs?
That we did it through our financial software. So everyone does not have access to the financial software now.
Okay. So now that is complete, and as I understand it, the town has to accept it, and then the auditor will make arrangements to come in and explain it.
The draft audit we should be receiving shortly. We don't even have the draft audit.
You don't have it yet. Okay, once you have it.
Once we have the draft audit, the Board of Selectmen will get a copy of the draft audit, and they have to sign off accepting it, and then they will print the books, and we'll post it online and all that.
Okay.
I
know everybody was concerned with the audit, so, Mike?
If I may, we can't consider any warrant articles that take out the undesignated fund balance until we know how much is in there. And it has to be the cash portion, not the taxes due portion. Thank you.
And we did get response from the assessing questions that we had on the consent agenda. Those have been forwarded to everyone. So one of the last questions is on the undesignated balances, the unreserved funds. Do you know when we'll get that? Is Fred is back here. I'm sorry. Jamie, for oblivion, you know.
Here, too. Yes.
No, you didn't have to move. It's just
he was hiding
from where I sit, he was no longer there.
I've been directed by my head boss to come back to you.
He sat there for
anybody
purpose.
Who listens to their boss.
I didn't hear that. When will we get that?
It will be in the audit, the designated fund balance. Will be the end of year undesignated fund balance, and then you will have to take off the $500,000 that the Board of Selectmen has voted to use to offset the tax rate. Plus, there was a warrant article that I think it was for the gristmill, the $400,000 had to go back into. So I think it's going to be right about 4.5 is my best guess. Once I haven't seen the audit, but once I see the audit, my the undesignated fund balance is at right about 4.5.
And we'll see an accounting for that.
Yeah.
When?
I gave it you an accounting of that back when.
But that's not that's not confirmed at this point in time.
Right.
We asked for a cash balance as well.
When are we getting this report?
Christy is saying that she has to wait until she gets the audit.
So that's from a year ago?
Yeah.
The fund
that's
balance from
a
year
ago.
Year ago.
Yes.
And
the
14.
Yes. Should have been done
that's
last
all you
spring.
Ever.
No, but I mean, we're going to be voting on warrant articles that relate to spending.
16.
I would think you'd want to know where is it as of the end of 15.
We'd like to know exactly what the auditors think at the end of 14.
That would be
so
logical.
Yeah.
This is town government.
Yes.
Well, let's put
let's
it
not
to
plow
you.
This ground again.
You know,
yeah. We just
not,
did this last meeting.
We did it last Tuesday.
Not to go on about this, we're going to deal with the warrant articles technically in 2016.
Okay.
And you'll have it. You'll either have information at that point, Scott, or you won't. Everybody will decide according to their principles on how they'll vote. Okay.
So did we get a date on...
No, we did not.
No, we don't have...
Undesignated fund balance.
We don't have a date.
Okay.
So that is clear.
So the expectation remains null and void.
Well...
Or at least null.
At this point, once the audit is in the hands and it is approved, then we'll see some sort of accounting from Christy. Okay. I will say that going this far out and having warrant articles that want to dip into these funds is putting those warrant articles to me in jeopardy at this point in time.
You know, really, I don't know. I don't really care about, necessarily the 014 audit in itself. The only one we need a statement from Plotzik and Sons or whoever,
Sanders.
Or from Friend, or Sanderson, what the undesignated fund balance is right now. And it's unofficial because, the audit itself hasn't been released. I don't really care about a lot of
that. 5 million.
You said 4.5 million.
That's the number she mentioned a month ago.
Yes.
So,
it is. You're right. When we talked to the Board of
Selectmen. Talked about it.
Yes.
Okay, so.
Madam Chairman, just a point of order. Can we get on with the budget? You know, the two gentlemen are sitting
can
here.
I understand that.
This
is part of the correspondence, so that's been
ongoing.
But can
we talk
Sandy?
About this later? I really would just like to move on with the budget.
Mm-hmm. Would you like to have us talk about it after you leave, Sandra? Is that what you want?
No,
all
let's
right.
talk about it after.
This
we've
is
got
part
the
of our
we've
business.
Got the fire but we've
job.
Got the fire department. We've asked them to come in. Let's do the budget and then do our business after.
Let's finish up what we started before we move on to the next thing, whatever that be.
Yeah. Right now we're done for the moment.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Sorry for taking up 5 minutes. We will move on. Page numbers.
OBS 11.
25.
And 25.
OBS 11. OBS 11 to me is Senor.
That's right here. OBS 11.
OBS 1.
That's a summary. It's a summary. The budget book is page 25.
Okay. Ah, very good. Thanks.
Okay.
Not the whole thing.
No, thank you.
Okay. No way.
Everyone content with the format we had last night to go
section
through
by section.
Section by section questions and then moving on. No, please don't jump ahead. Chief Iyer, what we did last night with the fire department, because your budget's so large.
Please
tell us. Department, sorry.
Night, 4
mm-hmm. We took section by section.
So we're doing fire prevention now, right?
We're doing fire prevention. We're doing administration.
Administration.
Page 25.
Page 25, or OBS 11.
It's right on top of fire.
No problem, I'm right there.
Okay, so we're going to take it section by section if anybody has any questions. That way we're not jumping all over the place. And I'm going to turn that section over to you to give us an overview.
Sure. The administration portion of the budget covers salaries and wages for staff, for myself, for the deputy, for the administrative assistants, and all of our uniforms, the career incentives, staff development, which you see is zeroed, rentals and leases for products in that we may use for our office supply, gasoline for our vehicles, and uniforms cover us all. There's a new line in there, which is 024422012400. Tuition reimbursement, that's correct. And that is to get us an appropriation line item to satisfy the requirements of the personnel policy of the town of Hampton. The department did not have a line item that was able to satisfy that requirement. However, staff have expressed the interest in going after reimbursement for tuition, which is a benefit that's been granted by the town for some time. We just had no mechanism to do that. So that's where that change comes in.
And the one I'm...
That's correct.
You probably should put a dollar in rather than zero.
There is. $2,500.
He's got $2,500.
Oh, you're just about town manager.
That's right.
$2,500. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. My overview. Do you have any questions?
We have questions.
Okay. We have questions.
Chairman.
Tim. Then.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening, sir.
The regular wages under administration are those people?
Myself, deputy, the administrative assistant, and I believe that that is it right now.
Three people.
Correct.
One of which is part-time, right?
No.
Okay.
We're all full-time.
So this is not the famous secretary we've been hearing so much about that's included
in fire prevention.
Yeah.
Different section.
Different section. I'll wait for that moment in time. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay, Jerry.
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions. On tuition?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we talked about it. It's a new line entry. My question is, do we have identified candidates projected with a high probability of utilizing this benefit?
We do.
Okay.
Actually, we have two who are probably the two smartest people in the department, and I see them...
I don't mind this at all, as long as we, you know, we have about like 85% or more probability that they're going to go.
Oh yeah, you know? Absolutely.
Uniforms.
Yes.
Two secretaries are listed as receiving uniforms. Is that what we normally do with secretaries? We give them uniforms.
Sure. Or they interact with the public every day, all day. As a matter of fact, we just mentioned fire prevention. That's our front window. Darian Malay, who is my administrative assistant, she's the go-between between public, between any staff and development. If somebody comes in to our organization for teaching or whatever, she's our go-between there. So they have uniforms. I don't believe Class A's.
They're $1,400 bucks for the two of them. I was just wondering. What kind of uniform is it? Is it a shirt?
Same as us. Yep.
Same deal.
Yep. Patches and all.
And my only comment is gasoline. You know, today's prices are $2 to $2.10 on the gas, regular gas, and on diesel it's $2.33 to $2.38. That's my only comment. So any prices listed in this book, as far as I'm concerned, is out of line with market.
I understand. It's
that's my point from the last time. That's all I have on administration.
That's for the whole budget tonight, right?
I'm not going to say this, what I just said again.
Okay, thank you.
Other than we're hitting gas again. Not a favorite subject. I won't have a card that says what I just said.
Yeah, just gas. Anyone else? Michael?
Following up on the gasoline question, why did you figure your gasoline per gallon or whatever for your budget?
I didn't. I believe the figure that we used was $2.34 per gallon at the time. Now, remember that this budget was assembled in May. It was refined in June and defended to the town manager. We presented it in June. We defended it in July. Mm-hmm. So this is several months ago.
Oh, yeah.
So I do believe that the price per gallon at the time was $2.34 for gasoline. I can't remember what it was for diesel offhand.
Okay. And that's where you fit.
What was it?
That's
235. 235. Yeah.
235, okay.
Yep.
Just curious.
And here we are. Diesel or? I'm sorry?
Do fire engines use diesel?
Yeah.
Fire engines, absolutely.
Right.
Our utility pickup truck uses diesel.
Well, that's a different price, isn't it?
Different price, yep.
Nobody. Diesel is a little bit more money.
A lot more money.
Well.
Used to be cheaper.
Any other questions?
I know. Why'd that change?
On this section. Okay, I just have one. On the uniforms, is that an allocation pretty much every year around 33,000?
Yes, ma'am.
How many people is that?
I believe out of this budget, there's five.
You got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
For our uniforms, it's different.
That's everyone doing the uniform.
That's my whole uniform. Okay, I'm sorry. That's our that's the entire department. The uniform balance of the entire department.
Everybody.
So
it's not just administration.
No.
On page 25, the exact positions.
It's all of them. Yeah. As you can see, under line item 4900.
Right.
So that's the regular shirts, Class B uniform, Class C, which is the polo shirts, boots, pants,
nope.
Class A's.
Interesting how many people that, how many
44,
individuals.
46.
Right. That. Yeah. Okay. I don't have any other questions.
Just have one thing. Under everything I've seen, it's $2.54 a gallon.
Yep, you're right.
Well,
right here.
Yes.
That's the
information. You were saying
I said $2.34. Yeah. That was memory. $2.54.
$2.54. Okay.
Updated.
Okay. All right. Moving on to fire suppression.
Fire suppression is what we do. That's the bulk of our work. Along with EMS, we're driving the fire engines. This is to cover all of the staff and personnel for that purpose. So everybody that you see wearing Hampton Fire Rescue uniform is performing tasks of fire suppression. Regular wages, their OT wages, we have part-time wages located in there. Currently you see that as zero, we don't have any part-time employees. OT wages, I know that I had a question and I did email that back. Does everybody understand the response that I gave you about the personnel that we've had out sick?
What was the question and the answer? I didn't get to anything like that.
I sent an email answer describing
Michael,
it was a
here
question.
You go. It went to you. He sent it to everyone.
It came in today. I don't
yeah, it
look
did
at
come
my
in
PC
today.
Today. I do that
there
right night before.
Correct. Yep. OT callback, there was another question. And the inquiry was regarding what am I anticipating next year? I can't anticipate fire. So in my description to you, I talked about the costs that are associated with a theoretical fire, a normal two-story cape type house, about $8,000 for a callback. If we get into a fire that was similar to the A block, we looked at $19,000 additional cost over duty crew. So that's a lot of money. And I can't tell you that we won't have more or less fire. I have no idea in 2016. We hope we have less. This year in 2015, we've seen a lot of significant fires and we've been very busy. So this line item is established so that I can pay the people to come back. Protective clothing has gone up. As I stated to you last year, I sat in front of you and told you that my plan is to do a program replacement for the gear. There was a great gear purchase with a grant in 2009. 33 sets of gear were purchased in 2009. They come to age in 2019. And after 10 years, the gear is no longer serviceable. Imagine wearing a snowsuit for every day, 365 days a year for 10 years. It just wears out. Fires do the same thing to it. Sunlight actually affects it. So I'm looking to get on a program where I'm replacing four sets a year so that in anticipation of the changeover of all of that gear in 2019, I'll have stemmed that off prior to so that the cost won't be so great. Let's see. You notice a change of minus 100% for fireworks detail wages?
Yes.
That is a significant change because the Board of Selectmen have voted on a fee schedule for our fire prevention office that incorporated some major changes. In that, the town budget no longer supported the details for any outside vendors with fireworks. It's not just the Hampton Beach fireworks that occur. We have others during the season. We had no means to charge, so this is a one-time change. And we've already been in discussion with the Hampton Beach voter precinct and village precinct to discuss what the change means to them. This is a charge that's going out for a fee for service for the officer to do the inspection, for the officer to stand by during the night while the fireworks are going on, and also for the firefighter who's going to be present during that detail. They're present at every fireworks detail, so that they're there. We have had injuries. They're there for a specific purpose. So.
So Chuck, that means more money in your budget.
No, we haven't been contacted by the selectmen about it yet. We have an agreement with the selectmen in the past, so as far as I'm concerned, we're still covered. So we need to hear from the selectmen before we change anything.
Okay.
Well, I was saying there's a one-year thing. Does this mean that line will be then filled again next year? Or?
Negative.
Okay.
No, I'm not sure if maybe I reiterated that incorrectly. This was a change on February 12th, 2015, we enacted a new fee schedule.
Okay.
Right? So this year, we absorbed the cost. It was in the budget. We absorbed the cost of this.
Yeah.
Okay. Moving forward,
okay.
The fund's empty.
All right. I just wanted to clarify that.
This year to date, we spent $69.69 there.
Yep.
In the last 4 years, we averaged $62.33. And there was nothing in there for 16 because you're saying the rules are changing.
That's correct.
Okay. That was one of the questions I had. But since he was on it and he elaborated on it, I jumped in here.
I have a question while we're here. So where's that revenue going to show up on that fee schedule then?
That's actually going back directly to the general fund.
General revenue, probably.
That doesn't come to
general revenue fund, so you don't have anything offsetting in your budget then.
Correct.
That's
time. That's actually, if I'm not mistaken, that goes to 26. I'm misspoken there. That goes to Fund 26, which we typically draw from on special details. The police officers have the special detail rate, Fund 26.
Oh, yeah.
That's where that goes. So that goes directly from the vendor to that fund. We pay our firefighters and officers out of that fund directly from there.
That's the same fund we used to buy the ambulances with.
Right? Negative. That's Fund 27.
What?
No.
No.
It's a detail wage fund. Fund 26, which is a detail wage, there's a line in there for fire.
Like the police.
Wait a minute. Fund 27 is emergency medical.
Yep. Correct. That is not the same fund. Fund 26.
26.
Okay.
Oh, 26 is private detail.
That's correct.
Yeah. And that's both. What is that, just for fire or police and fire?
There's a fire line item in there for us.
There's a fire line item in there for you. Okay.
We have significantly
less.
So
that's where that revenue would go.
That's true. Gotcha. With some of the construction that's been going on at the beach lately, they've had to have fire details as they're doing welding inside of a occupied structure. So the funding for that, we generate a cost. The invoice goes to that account, and that's how we pay our money.
And you can do
the outside
billing.
Correct.
That's a good move.
Except Chuck doesn't know anything about it.
So you have authority to draw on that fund?
For the purpose of paying the firefighters.
Expenses occur.
Correct.
Chuck, you got parking revenue coming in.
The town gets parking revenue from
fireworks
as well. They're
getting paid their wage. It's not coming out of the bottom line budget for the fire department. It's not coming out of the special detail that the vendors are paying.
All right.
Right, so it's coming out of the fund, which is an expense authorization from the fund, the disbursement that you authorize alone? Or is that authorized by the selectmen as well? Or?
No, that's an expense that comes into the fund.
It goes in.
Only one way, in.
One way.
Right. So when they're paid, it's not coming out of the bottom line for regular wages or overtime wages. It's actually coming out of the 26 fund instead of the 42 funds that you see for us. For
right, 26 fund. Is actually being withdrawn from the payment, right?
Oh, is
right.
It?
Right.
So that withdrawal is authorized by you?
For the mechanics of it, I believe that's authorized by finance, right? The withdrawal of the 26 fund. That's not coming from the fire department.
It's coming in your payroll.
Right. It's essentially under our payroll, but it's coming out of the fund that's designated for the vendors.
I got you. Who authorizes the disbursement from that fund?
That's,
you do?
Yeah, that's part of the fire department's. Okay. Right.
You do?
For the regular wages, right.
And over here. Like it.
Questions? Hands? Anyone?
Right.
Brian?
I got questions on that.
Brian and Jerry?
Yeah. Overtime wages, I'm just trying to get a handle on this because I see one just about in every category.
Did you read
that? Is this. No. Yeah, I did read that. Is this. Covering for people that are multitasking, per se?
I don't
know. Will you have an old-time account in just about every... I mean, if I... Today I'm doing fire suppression. Tomorrow I could be doing training or anything else. Is this to cover?
No. So shift work is covered right here, right? If they come in for EMS training, that's covered under Fund 27. We have a line item for training, so they'll get overtime through that account.
Okay.
If they're coming in for any other type of task, well, fire prevention, we're looking at different entities here, really, within.
That's what I
so the fire said. Suppression personnel, when they come in to do a day shift for a vacancy, whether it be due to sick or injury, they're paid out of, that's the overtime line item for that.
Okay. That was perfect.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jerry?
Yeah. Okay. On the protective clothing part of it.
Yes, sir.
Just go through these. Are we going to have a warrant article on that? Didn't I hear as part of the selectmen's meeting that we're going to have a warrant article to replace this protective clothing to your cycle that you mentioned?
Yep.
If so, what's this? Is this?
Well, next year, we've sustained a lot of change at Hampton Fire Rescue. Mm-hmm. This year we'll have had 11 new positions, four of them new firefighters, all of them getting new gear. So with those four sets of gear coming in, I'm looking at purchase. I can't give them what we have in attic stock, if you would. We don't have attic stock for gear anymore.
So you're going to be a warrant article plus
the warrant article is going to start the transition to the six sets posted for that warrant article. I would theoretically, anyway, if you do the math out, with the new four hires here, I will have to buy 36 sets of gear by 2019 because the four will be taken care of immediately. This warrant article is to start that process.
So how many?
The four here are going to cover my new guys. And then there's four more you'll see the four that I've purchased already, or I'm purchasing in the future, they're out of this particular fund.
Oh, there's four sets here.
That's correct. Well, I'm going to need three, just so that we're all clear. I'm going to need three here. I have one new guy that's already started 6 months ago, buying him new gear. So those four will be good. The six sets are additional, six sets of gear.
And they're going to be in the warrant? What's in the warrant? How many sets?
Six. 18,000.
So six are in the warrant.
Four new that I need next year. Each year we replace gear. If you imagine a burning building that has a lot of shop objects, has a lot of problems with it.
No, I understand.
We're replacing hoods, so that's what we're doing with the four sets each year. I'm replacing burnt gear. I'm replacing faded gear that's been UV damaged.
So you're using both the warrant article and the operating
correct
budget to get your sets what you have. Now, where are all these new positions?
I also have old. I have old gear. There's at least four firefighters currently working that were not issued new gear at their start. So they're wearing other personnel's gear.
Hand-me-down?
Yeah. Now, if you imagine, if I was to share gear with Mr. Jones, we wouldn't fit. Mr. Bridle and I, we might fit. So if we were to look at that from that perspective, gear is fit to the firefighter.
I got you.
And currently right now, we've already had to purchase two new sets because of, one was pants were too short. They didn't belong to him, and they were purchased for somebody else. We had to buy him new pants. He never got a set of new pants. Another firefighter had worn through his gear. It was 6 years old, so we replaced a set of gear. The four that we see here is the kickoff for my next year beginning purchase. So the warrant article is to establish that fund moving forward so that I can grow or at least eliminate the need to replace 33 sets in four more years.
It's confusing.
It is confusing. There's a lot of gear.
Let me ask you, Chief. This is protective clothing, right?
Yes, sir.
So this year,
correct,
you had a budget of 16,000,
correct,
and was complemented by 10,668 encumbrance, for a total of 26,000 or so. So how? And year to date, you've only spent 70% of that. I'm wondering if you can use some of this money. I'll just lay it on the table. You can't make that decision. But if there's money left over from this year, maybe you can buy some of these sets.
Well, if you've actually seen what we haven't done yet, and now we're coming into the winter season.
Yeah.
Recently, if anybody's watched the news, you've seen there's been a big push talking about firefighter safety and carcinogens.
Yeah.
Hoods, primarily. We wear Nomex hoods. You've seen them on race car drivers, whatever it might be. Our Nomex hoods right now, we've only replaced three, I think, in the last 3 weeks. We just replaced three of them. They're $58 a piece. I need to buy 50 of them. At the end of the day, they don't last very long because they're constantly on and off. And not only that, they have such a high exposure because they're always exposed to smoke and heat that they need to be replaced. They're also finding that the Nomex, as opposed to what we're wearing, retains the carcinogens for a much longer time. So I haven't done that yet. I haven't purchased new gloves. We're coming into winter. Gloves get destroyed. These are the line items that I take for that.
Almost 8K left to do that, and that one.
I still haven't bought new gear for the guys who are coming in right now.
Yeah. Now, what are all these new positions? I mean, I wasn't aware that we had all these open positions. 11 positions you mentioned.
11 changes. So, well, we had me as acting chief. I became the appointed chief in June, right?
Yeah.
I had Deputy Kennedy step up from captain in November of last year, and he was appointed in August. We had two vacancies created by the move-ups. We had a captain's position, which Captain McMahon filled. We had Firefighter Murray changed to Lieutenant Murray, and he was promoted to lieutenant. We have had an EMS officer who was appointed. We had a fire prevention officer that was appointed, and in doing so, that created two additional vacancies. We hired Ryan Hickey in May. We have two vacant positions right now, and we have a pending medical retirement. So that will be my fourth firefighter for the year. So those are the open positions.
So how many firefighter, how many people total did you have in your department, including yourself, starting January of this year?
40 minus.
Starting in January 1st of 2015, how many did you have? Total.
Yeah, minus the fire inspector, which was an unfunded position, we had 46.
46.
Correct.
And what are you
about? That's not true. We had 45.
45.
I was the acting chief.
45. Okay. What are you going to have? What are you?
My full complement is 46, and then if we fund the fire inspector's position, it's 47.
Okay. So going into January of 2016, you're looking for 47? Is that what it is?
Yes. Actually, it'll be after the warrant articles. The fire inspector's position
is the fire inspector in the warrant article?
Correct.
Ah.
So right now I'm going to have 46. I have two. We're waiting on background checks on two firefighters, which will give me a complement of 46 at this time with one medical.
So you promoted somebody who was a fireman?
Yes.
To a fire inspector?
No, not yet. No. That position's vacant.
Oh, I thought it was already.
Fire prevention officer. Yes, sir. Bill Payne.
Yeah, but is he inspecting?
Yes.
Okay, so yep. He's inspecting. So now you're looking to backfill from his vacant spot with that warrant article.
Correct. I have a vacant spot right now.
Okay.
No, sir. Not with the warrant article. Inspector's position is a separate position.
Yeah.
So the fire prevention officer.
But you promoted somebody into.
No. I promoted the fire prevention officer. So if you imagine, if we look at fire prevention, I know we're not there, Madam Chair, but if we look at fire prevention, we have a fire prevention officer, we have a fire inspector, and we have a secretary.
Okay.
Part-time right now. All right,
so you don't have the fire inspector?
Not yet. Nope. Okay.
So is that going to be in the warrant article?
His position, the funding for that position that exists, it's
for the fire
inspector
position will be a warrant article position.
Correct. We saw that one last year and the year before as well.
And it didn't work, right?
I believe that right now we have done some great, great tasks with the Fire Prevention Bureau, and I believe that very warranted. So.
Okay, so we'll expect to see the warrant article then on the fire inspector. All right, okay. Overtime callback was a knockout. You explained it, okay. However, it really I can't get it down because, you know. Year to date, 2015, you've spent around $10,000 so far, through October anyway. In the last 4 years, you averaged out at $15,000, and now you're asking for $52,000.
That's consistent with what I have no other mechanism to fund them. So, as I explained in the email, so if I have a first alarm fire, that means that I'm bringing back recall for all fire department personnel. If they all come back to fight the fire, I have to pay them. I can't not pay them.
I agree with you there, sir.
So if we have two fires, and I have spent $16,000, and that's my line item, I can't pay them.
Yeah, I have trouble with it, though. The only thing I can go by is what history has shown.
Yeah, that's...
You didn't spend it this year, and you didn't spend it the last 4 years.
But history has also shown that Hampton Beach has a lot of fire and a lot of...
We also have... You know, I only want to piggyback with that. I know as we scrutinize these things, and I hear what you're saying, it wasn't spent in the past, but we also have added a lot more property out there and a lot higher property out there.
Thank you for recognizing that.
So I that may not even be sufficient.
Madam Chairman, if I can draw an analogy here, if I may. We had a wicked year this year with snow.
Mm-hmm.
Was it 250 or 300,000 spent in the line item, whatever it was?
Mm-hmm.
Are we now going to budget $500,000 a year in that particular account to accommodate for that possibility?
No, but I don't think that is one old salt can wipe out that in another department's budget if it becomes necessary. It's kind of like we budget with the schools, Jerry, for special ed.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I think, yeah, if you don't use it, that's great. But I don't, that's one line I wouldn't want to be caught short on. One thing I do want to ask you, though, while we're on personnel, have we increased our complement at all? Or are we
still,
we have not?
No, and on that same topic, this year, mm-hmm. I ran to a minimum of 8. Not advisable, because our maximum, or our current staffing allows for 9. Through the summer, based on the storms, and you know, Mr. Zanoy just brought up the storms, we staffed during the storms at storm level. So we brought in the 9th man, and we also overstaffed with 2, and I was paying them the overtime coming out of the Fund 27, the EMS budget, because I was trying to maintain that. But we had so much snow, as everybody knows, we all shoveled it. We had so much snow then, and then when you plow, I'm glad for you. Our guys shoveled their houses out, then they came in, they shoveled hydrants. They were working round the clock during the snowstorms. When they did come in, we had to pay them, obviously. It was so early in the season, it was even before the budget had been voted on, we had to be very careful, and then through the rest of the season, I had to staff at 8, so I didn't staff at 9. During the summertime, when we typically staff at 9, our highest season, I was unable to do that because I was concerned about the overtime, and we were watching it significantly. I had a lot of people out, as I explained to you in the email. So
here's my question to you. Are we going to see call for additional manpower?
It's my goal eventually to do that, but
we're going to see it in
20? Not this year.
We are not.
No.
I personally hope we see it next year. Disappointed that we're not seeing it now. Mm-hmm. To add this for new members here.
It's not warrant article time.
Excuse me. I'm talking about the budget itself right now. Going back at this point, maybe 12 years ago, I forget the name of the study that's done nationally that tells you
How
many people you should have.
17.
And I would think that the way we've grown, we have a lot more buildings than we had 12 years ago. I believe the number was 18 and 19 for coverage in this town, and we are at 8.
You couldn't be more correct on that. You really couldn't. You've absolutely hit it out of the park. Additionally, you know, we're looking at summertime. We're actually at a meeting yesterday when we were discussing changes to the beachfront and traffic. Everybody knows that the beach is great, but you can't get off of it or you can't get onto it because of traffic. Imagine now that if we have an incident and we're trying to draw in extra staff, we're calling them from home, they can't get here in a timely fashion. So we need the personnel on duty at the time. I felt that it was premature to ask for it at this time because we want to do it right. We want to spell it out, the reasons why, how we're going to be able to do it. I don't want to come to you, you know, with a half-baked idea. I want to give you a complete plan so that when we move forward, we can actually say this is completely transparent and makes sense. Now, to quote 1710, say we need it because they said it, I want to show you and demonstrate that we need it because we need it. And I think that will not be hard to do. But I have to make sure that it's done correctly.
I think it would help also if you paralleled, you looked at other towns that were of our size, relatively speaking, 15,000 year-round residents. I know we
Jerry, there's nobody like us.
In the summer, we differentiate ourselves
in
the summer.
But there's nobody like us. And because we have beach the way it is, we have much greater need. And as far, I'm going to turn it over to Tim in a minute before his hand falls off. But when, as far as I'm concerned, this is a good budget under this. I don't see how you can do anything with your overtime unless you start to put more full-time staff in there. And that's all I'm going to say about it. Tim?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Fire suppression is the topic, right?
Yes, sir. And
this is where the famous secretary is, right?
No, sir.
Okay?
No, sir.
I do have other questions.
Sir. Okay.
I don't want to miss the secretary, so.
That's fine. On one of the same topic, but if I could just elaborate for 1 second. I've been sitting in front of the Board of Selectmen a couple of times now, and I've talked to them, and each time that I sit there, I discuss what our run rate is and how it looks year over year.
Yeah.
And last year, 2014, we had a banner year. It was the highest volume that we had ever seen.
We are exceeding that. Fire suppression, fireside, we're exceeding that by over 150 calls year to date. We continue to grow. It's not, I love to tell you, oh, well, it's only in the summer. It's not anymore. We're busy all the time. We're busy throughout the year. Now, summertime, we get hammered, just like you would expect. I know that the police do the same thing. But throughout the course of the year, Hampton's becoming a busier place, period. I think that half of it is the growth that we're seeing. If you look down at the beach, I was hired in 2012. And if you go out on an ocean-going vessel and you look at the cityscape in 2012, and you look at it again today, not even close to what it was. So with that growth comes more volume. There's more people here. They're going to call the ambulance. They're going to call for fire, whatever it might be. Our inspections are through the roof. I know that you're going to see the building inspector, and he's going to tell you he's very busy. We're doing inspections alongside him. Yeah. We're extremely busy in that department right now. We have a lot of growth in this town, and it continues. Mm-hmm. So to say that the summer is our busy time, that's a very accurate statement. But we need it all year long. We're seeing rapid growth here, and our call volume is absolutely demonstrated.
You know, one of the things
I continue with my time, please. Had you already started?
I thought she was barely. I thought she was. Right. One of the things is the population is aging.
No,
that was a no. That was a no. Sorry.
Then Steve and you. Let's go in order, guys.
I'm sorry.
Let's keep going. Let's keep going.
Jeez, I don't want to. Yeah, let's keep going, Jerry.
The fire suppression. That's where the fire inspections take place. Yes.
No, sir.
Okay.
That's also under fire inspection.
Okay, you mentioned earlier a conversation with Mr. Zanoy about snow shovelers. That's a fire suppression activity?
Well, our firefighters
yes
go
no?
out there, yes. They go out and shovel hydrants.
So I have a question.
Now, we also,
Let me ask my question.
All right.
So you said you're employing firefighters to go out and shovel hydrants, et cetera, et cetera.
And we're employing firefighters, they shovel hydrants.
Right. Is that what I heard?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if we don't, and there is a fire, we don't have time to shovel.
Yeah, I think he's getting at something else.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I assume they're getting their regular pay rate there. Sometimes overtime. You mentioned overtime even. Right?
True.
Yeah. And I assume that these firefighters are getting rather tired doing all that shoveling.
It's true.
So if a fire hits after they get done all that shoveling,
exhausted,
we're going to have a problem fighting that fire.
Amen.
So does it not make sense to actually employ someone who's not a firefighter to do the shoveling?
Well, we know where the hydrants are. So if
well,
you're
can tell any you
it is. you'd be surprised. You know what? This year we had 5 foot snowbanks. And you've seen the little lollipops that we put on there, right? So that you can identify the hydrants. They weren't identifiable this year. This was a unique year. But I think that's what's coming. So we do hire in, we overstaff on staff on storm coverage. We try to defer the work out a little bit. But if I was to hire in just to shovel hydrants, then I would be answering to you, why am I hiring in just to shovel hydrants and there's other reasons that we could be using our staff.
Well, the answer would be easier, because hiring people who are unemployed will probably require less pay.
But they wouldn't be able to work for me. You know what I mean?
Why not?
Not union. Well,
because there would be union contracts that would have to be signed. I don't have a part-time position for that. Are they medically cleared? There's a whole bunch
of
stuff.
You cannot hire an independent contractor to do a fire hydrant shoveling?
No, we work in conjunction with DPW, however, and Aquarian Water.
So DPW could be doing the fire hydrant shoveling on your behalf.
No, they're plowing. So they're helping.
No, no. If they, in fact, hired additional help to do so.
Okay.
They could do that, right?
That would be a miracle.
I mean, it wouldn't violate any union contract, would it?
No, but that's also not up to the fire.
I understand. I just want to get clarity that we're actually burning up firefighter energy at the very worst time. I mean, if you have a snowstorm and then you're out there showing fire hydrants and then you have a fire, that's one of the worst possible conditions for fighting a fire.
I agree.
And we're making it worse by exhausting the firemen shoveling snow.
Very good point.
I agree completely.
So we're exacerbating a very serious condition, and town management ought to look at a better solution.
I think that's a very good point, Tim.
If you shovel up the hydrants and break them off,
how is that?
Well, you know, and the point that I was going to get when I interrupted you there for a moment, Mr. Jones, is that, you know, we do ask that citizens out there who adopt a hydrant. So your nearest hydrant, please go shovel it out.
That's not a bad idea.
Yep, we've asked that now for 2 years. We've been asking, please, and I know that for years. I've only been asking for a year and a half, but please go adopt a hydrant. If you see one in front of your house, shovel it out. If you see one in front of your neighbors, especially if it's an elderly neighbor, please go shovel it out.
Please give them an incentive to do so.
Why?
That's all I'm suggesting.
Your fire safety should be plenty of
incentive. I would think so.
Well, obviously it isn't.
All right, there's several points on here. Tim, do you have any more questions?
Yes, I do. Thank you, Madam Chair. I do.
All right. Stephen.
Yes, I do, Madam Chair.
Oh, sorry. Oh,
geez, you're going to get me in trouble again.
Okay.
You mentioned
I love being ignored.
You're doing a good job.
Chief, you mentioned manpower under fire suppression earlier, in terms of manpower needs. And I was interested in knowing, how does your manpower this year compare with your manpower last year?
Last year, we were able to staff appropriately through the summer at 9. This year, we were unable. Last year, we had significantly less injury that was long-term. So we weren't paying out overtime through that, and we were able to cover the costs of staffing at 9. So if a person takes vacation or is out sick on a 9-man day, we'll cover to the 9th man. If we are down to 8 because there's somebody out on injury and I have to cover to the 9th man all the time, then I'm burning up overtime pretty quick. And if somebody takes vacation or is out sick on that same shift, now I have 2 in our overtime.
So your manpower last year is comparable to your manpower this year in terms of...
In terms of number, they're
right,
the same.
In terms of number, they're the
in
same.
In terms of staffing, it was down because of injuries.
Well, you have human factors to deal
correct.
With every year.
Correct.
And they're largely unpredictable, really.
That's true.
Yeah. So, but basically, you had the same manpower this year as last year, and this budget is reflecting the same power next year as well. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
I'm going to get my people healthy.
Are we clear now?
Yeah, the building inspector's not in this section, so I'll wait on that question. And I believe there's a statement in here in the details that says the Hampton Fire Rescue will begin a program replacement of gear purchased in 2009.
Right.
This is the appropriate time to discuss that, right?
That's the one that Mr. and I were just talking about.
Right. The recommended life expectancy of firefighter gear is 10 years.
That's correct.
All gear purchased by AFG, whoever they are.
Assistance Firefighters Grant.
Great. Grant in 2009 will be needed to be replaced in 2019.
Correct.
We are beginning the cycle of replacement to defer cost over time. How much is the cost of that program in this budget?
In this budget, we're talking about the 4 gear sets that are there. It's 11.6, but we're also kickstarting with the additional warrant that we already spoke about.
So it's 11,600 in this budget.
Right. Not including the additional...
For this program.
That's just gear. Right. Well, the total is there. So I believe it was 16,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that 11,600 reflects
that's
this
just gear,
program
jacket.
Replacement.
No.
Okay, that's
no,
my
that's
question.
Private. Right, no.
How much money is reflective in this program replacement that you're beginning this year?
I wish I could just give you a straight answer.
I wish
that.
You could, too.
Yeah, it's transparent, though, because at the end of the day, I can't replace gear that's worn or broken down right now because I have too many new hires and I have to get them gear. So that's where I am on this budget cycle. I'm at a place where I'm buying new gear for new people that I want to be replacing gear. I just can't. That's why I submitted the warrant article. And I guess I didn't explain that well enough.
No, that element is fine.
Yep.
It's the note that I'm trying to put dollar number to.
Yep.
The note is there because it has importance.
That's true.
And it says it's a program replacement.
Yep.
Okay. So therefore, I would assume there's some dollar calculation
moving
that
forward,
resulted from this program.
That. Right.
And I just want to know what that dollar number is.
$16,000.
$16,000 that begins this program of replacement.
Minus 3, because I have 3 new firefighters.
Minus 3,000.
They'll be withdrawing from that immediately. So they're not new. I'm not able to replace. I have to buy new with them.
Fine, I understand.
Yep. So 16, there we go. So one set of gear.
$16,000 minus how much?
One set of gear.
How much
right,
is that?
Will be for the program replacement this year. For jacket and pants, it's and helmet and boots, $2,900.
So $16,000 minus $3,000, basically.
Correct.
So it's $13,000 for the commencement of this program.
No, sir. $3,000 will end up beginning the program. The rest will be, unfortunately or fortunately, buying new gear for the new people who come through the door.
So $3,000 of this is for the beginning of this program.
Right.
The other replacement side of it is just happenstance because you have new bodies requiring new uniforms. Right,
right? But I wanted to replace that for 10 years.
I got it. So it's really $3,000 as it stands right now.
For the new part of the program.
Right, and it may turn out to be zero if you have to hire another one, right? And I understand that, but it's $3,000. Thank you, Chief.
Hi.
Michael.
While we're on the protective
toilet. Michael, then Sonny.
You said you had all these people you need to buy protective clothing for. People got promotions. So when you get a promotion, you can't wear your old protective gear?
No, they all did, as a matter of fact.
They can't. So if you got promoted to fire chief from wherever you were before, you can still wear yours.
We put a patch on the back of my jacket.
And you can wear yours. So out of all those people that were changed, or where there's quite a few of them that just got promoted, they can still wear their old uniform.
Yep, Captain McMahon, we changed over lettering. Lieutenant Murray, we changed over lettering. Fire prevention and EMS, changed over lettering.
Good show. That's all I wanted to know. Thank you.
Sonny.
Yeah. On overtime on shoveling snow, that's probably a big item on snow.
We staffed up, right? So we had the storm. I put on storm coverage. Those firefighters were tasked with all the day's duties, and during the day, when they weren't doing calls, they were shoveling hydrants. So,
Another question: when you go out on the EMT and the fire engine goes out, does that generate overtime as well?
If the ambulance transports, we will call back personnel. If they are coming in to cover the ambulance call, then they're being funded, their overtime is being funded out of the EMS budget, okay, not out of the fire line item.
I've got a suggestion on shoveling the hydrants. Why don't you ask the Boy Scouts to do it? It wouldn't be a union issue for you. If they'd get a badge for it, they'd probably love to do it.
The last thing I want to do is put Boy Scouts in the middle of a storm out on the side of a road.
Oh, they're out shoveling anyway.
I really don't.
I mean, I plowed the fire hydrant across the street from these.
There are some things out there that
we're always looking for free labor. Why don't we get some prisons there?
Can I ask something more?
Yeah. Another question.
All right. Steven?
Sonny's got one more.
Go ahead, Sonny. Finish up.
False alarms. How many did you have?
I don't have that information in front of me. I could certainly get it for you.
Yeah. So. We do not.
There is a mechanism in town, I do believe it's in the ordinances, that allows us, if it becomes a problem with a certain venue, that we could recover a small amount of the costs, but we haven't had to do that. Typically, our false alarms have been resolved with communication with fire alarm companies.
Steven.
Since everybody's talking about snowstorms, of course, last year was unusual, but correct me if I'm wrong, there was a tractor in the beach fire station that I understand that the DPW lent you.
It was on loan.
On loan from DPW so that you could use that so that the firemen wouldn't be getting too tired shoveling.
That came late in the game.
I know, but yep. You did
after
get that.
After they were exhausted, right?
You did get that, Chief. And the other thing is that on the news last year, again, being an unusual year, there was at least one town in Massachusetts, there might have been more, that had a program, Adopt a Fire Hydrant, and they were giving out, I think it was McDonald's, was every time you did this, you'd get a free certificate to buy a Whopper or something, right, or French fries.
Oh, they had an incentive. Amazing.
But... are you familiar with that? Did you hear about that at all?
I remember hearing about something it. I didn't research it, but
But I think it's a good idea it's an incentive, but if there is a hydrant in front of your house, for instance, in mine. But at the same time, I remember last winter, there was a lot of concern about a neighbor of mine, an elderly neighbor that was completely snowed in and nobody had seen her for a couple of weeks. So I called Fred's office. He said, call the fire department. And the fireman, along with myself, we shoveled her out. Yes, and after that, they kept shoveling it out all winter long because there was no way to get in or to get out if there had been some type of an emergency. So
it's the right thing to do.
You got to do it. That's what the job is, you know? So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Scott.
Just to Sonny's point, I was raised in Georgetown, Massachusetts. As a Boy Scout, we shoveled fire hydrants. That was what we did.
In a valley. Yep. Wow.
Well, you got a new chance now.
I'm going to take care of the one in front of my house for sure.
Jerry?
We could have an adopt a hydrant program, like you say. I thought that's good. That's a yes.
Yep.
Replacement equipment.
Yes, sir.
This is an eye popper for me.
Okay.
We budgeted the original request for this from you and Fred was $18,200 for the budget. The default budget gave you $25,360. And then there was an encumbrance for $24,360 more for a total of $50,010 for that line item. Year to date spent, zero.
Well, the encumbrance is the main line item there. Mm-hmm. And that encumbrance is for traffic preemption lights down at Braun Avenue at Ashworth.
Mm-hmm.
They were removed during the construction process and the demolition of 64 Ashworth Ave.
Yeah.
We have been seeking a way to do it. And Captain Justin Cutting has been working diligently with Electric Light to make this happen. We've run into some cost overrides because of utility costs that were going to be associated with attaching to the poles. So currently, along with the DPW and their assistants, Captain Cutting actually had a meeting with them this morning. We're working out a different way to do it, but we're trying to put in lights, and it's not going to be the same system that we're typically used to.
Yeah.
But he's looking at a way to make this occur. The reason that it hasn't been expensed is because we haven't been able to do it. The cost overrides for using utility poles was just too great.
This is at, like, this is at the corner of Brown and Ashworth, right?
Correct.
Right. I think I remember that at one of the selectmen meetings there was a discussion on this. But
right. I actually forwarded a letter to the town manager to say we can't do it for this price. It's my recommendation that we liquidate the PO. He actually is the one who said we need to do it, and we need to do it this way. Let's use the DPW. So we're researching other ways to do it. We really want to accomplish
it. You think
you
can do it this year?
Well, we have to, because that's what the encumbrance says. So I'm hoping that we can, but we're looking at fading daylight.
I was, okay, I'm glad you reminded me of that. I
yeah.
kind of forgot that. I was just, when I was looking at the budget, I see 50K here in that line item, and nothing was spent.
Yeah.
I said, wow, what happened here? And I'm glad you reminded me of that.
Yes, sir.
So we didn't spend anything out of the other allocation of 25,360 from a default point of view, and an 18,200 per an original request point of view. We didn't spend anything there either.
Any more questions?
I'm not done.
I
haven't heard an answer here.
The replacement equipment that you're referencing, that particular line item,
yeah.
was, and I don't have that as that, the 50 grand.
Well, you have a 24,650 encumbrance.
That's correct.
And you have a 25,360 budget.
That's right. And we haven't replaced, currently this year, our goal was to replace that line item, I mean that those lights. The additional monies there have unfortunately been used for other replacement equipment. When it comes to, we've seen it go to replacing pots.
So you use the money on other line items and use it here.
Right.
So this year you're asking for 17,800.
Correct. Because that's what we're projecting we're going to need.
Okay. Okay, well, let's hope we can use it for that particular line item.
That's my goal.
One other thing.
Okay.
Technical hazard expense.
Yes.
This is my last comment on this particular section. Year to date, yep. if we analyze it, you've spent about $1,700 bucks. The last 4 years, you've averaged $12,600. And the request this year is $21,250.
You're not seeing it all when you're looking at the numbers, because
yep.
we have a start assessment which has gone up by $1,250 this year. Our instructor costs for next year are going up as well. We have annual hazmat training that needs to occur, and the instructor costs are going up on that. So that's what's being taken account into that line item. We haven't finished with the technical hazards this year, so
yeah,
we've also
is,
just
this is only through October, so
right.
you might have November and December
that's
costs
right.
coming in there.
That's right.
So I mean, it's
so the increase. If I'm reading this, if we're
it's
on
about
the same
it's about a 8K increase.
8K.
Over the last 4 years, you've averaged 12.7. You're now asking for 21.
Right. Well, we've seen an increase in what it's costing us to do business. So with the regional hazmat team, the START team, mm-hmm. it's our dues went up by $1,250 this year to $7,250, I believe. So that's part of it.
Is this this that START assessment?
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did circle that $7,250. It says here.
So they are a regional hazmat team, and if we need them, we call them out, and they come to our community, and they serve us in a capacity to deal with mitigated
hazmat. And what was that assessment last year?
It was in the $6,000 range. It went up by $1,250. I believe we're at $7,250 now.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yep.
That's another case though on hazmat. You get one. Significant spill and
you use everything.
You blow everything.
That's true.
It kind of fits the the flyer issue.
Well, yeah, and if you imagine, I mean, we have some major highways going through town, and
yeah, 95.
Yeah, they've got all kinds of hazardous materials that go up and down. So it takes one rollover to. If you recall, I think it was 2010, Amesbury and Newburyport line at the bridge. There was a gas tank rollover, and there was 10,000 gallons of gasoline that was spilled. That could happen today in this community. We got knock wood that we don't have it, but if it did, we need the response.
Mm-hmm. I'm right, done Jerry, with the section. I'm not saying anything about gas and diesel.
Okay, thank you very much. Fire prevention. We have some increases here.
We do. Percentage-wise, they look like a lot. Numbers-wise, if you look across at the line items, they are not. And I'll tell you where some of this new equipment is. I'll tell you where some of the are not. We have no new equipment purchased. Gasoline, I've left in there in anticipation of the hiring of a fire inspector. He's going to be driving a vehicle, and we need to be able to supplement his gasoline. Or her gasoline. Supplies and expenses, they've increased. We had to purchase a color printer. We're currently using a void proof certificate. Actually, you can see one in the corner of the room over here, where if we're issuing a certificate for permit of occupancy, for a permit of assembly, we're unable to do this without the idea that we have, just like on a check, if you scan it or if you photocopy it, it would read void. We've purchased the paper to do that. We have a new printer that's able to accommodate that, and the ink and toner, it's all a increased cost. We know that moving forward. Supplies and expenses are there. We've also had an extremely successful year for fire education, both in the grade school area, and this morning we just saw 21 students come from homeschooling to the fire station. We are now working very hard in maintaining a national protocol. Bill Payne, who is our fire prevention officer, and Stephanie Welch, our fire prevention secretary, worked diligently through the month of October for Fire Prevention Week. We saw 384 kids this year. Last year we saw zero. So they all came through this program, and he's working with the national standard, hear the beep, we asleep. So this is, we were buying supplies to promote that.
Okay. Any questions in this section? All right.
Yeah, I've got Tim.
Finally, I get to talk about the fire prevention section.
You do.
Right? Excellent. I've heard wonderful things about our new fire prevention secretary. She has made great strides in terms of productivity, so much so that any hiring of additional fire prevention officers or inspectors seems to be something we can defer. Is that true?
No. So her job has been to maintain and organize the office. She has been absolutely, you know, outstanding in doing so. For years, there was paper files, as you might imagine. We're moving to get that digitized so that we can have a site file. We use IMC currently. We're exploring other opportunities. But with IMC, we're able to now see what kind of building we're going to, see what's available. She's updating that database. She's maintaining the database, and she's getting out information sooner to the businesses so that we can preempt the strike if we have to and say, hey, listen, you need to get us the hood report. You need to get us all of the fire alarm and sprinkler reports. So what she's done there is the beginning. We still need people out to inspect.
Just in summary, what she's actually done is she's more fully utilized computer technology to this operation much more efficient.
Correct.
And you're looking forward to still more efficiencies deeper use of computer technology. And I really celebrate that a great deal, because that is exactly the kind of thing that needs to happen in virtually every section of this town.
We have a project that you're going to be very excited about.
And I'm very excited about watching further progress there, because as far as I can tell, you guys are holding the banner for where the whole town should be going in that area.
Thank you, sir.
But I have been hearing in various fora that this organization, well, it was last year we had a problem getting permits out, right?
Yeah.
But this organization that the new secretary has brought to bear already, and there's still going to be more optimization taking place in the future, we anticipate, that because of that, this year we had no problems at all with regard to getting licenses out on time, right?
Correct.
Whereas the previous argument was we needed another fire inspector to make that happen. So this new secretary has saved the town a lot of money.
She has saved a lot of grief.
A lot of grief as well.
A lot of grief. I would reference one thing. that during the interim, when our fire prevention officer was out, the deputy and I did the inspections. We did. I'm the one who was doing all the fire investigations. When we were dealing with permitting, we were the ones who had to go to the venues for all of them. We were the ones reviewing plans. So all of this change that occurred, she did the administration side. We were two people working through the inspection side. Currently, Bill Payne, who's our fire prevention officer, he's doing a tremendous job, by the way. He's doing that right now. This is slow season, and there's no doubt that you know why, because businesses are closed down at the beach. Come April and May, he's going to be going out straight, right?
Yeah, day, night, and all. But with that new optimized organization, you're much better able to orchestrate the personnel in such a way that the grief is not being realized. And I'm not saying, well, whether you need another one or whether it could be useful or not, that's another discussion for another day, I guess. Did you suggest that there is another warrant article out this year for an additional fire inspection?
No, it's so the funding position that's there. There's a vacancy right now, right?
So there is an open vacancy that's funded
that's
in this
unfunded.
Budget.
Unfunded, correct.
It's not funded.
Not funded in the budget, funded by warrant.
So there is a warrant article out there.
Correct. For the inspector's position.
I thought that was whole. I guess my memory is failing in my ever greater old age.
Okay.
Apologize for that. So anyway, I look forward to further discussion about in future about this wonderful optimization of computer technology, because it's something that I think the entire town needs to look at and say, hey, now there's a standard bearer for making our operations efficient without increasing cost, really, when you come down to it. Right? You decrease it. Increased efficiency, lower cost. I love it. That's exactly what computer technology is for. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Tim. Nick.
Just a couple clarifications, Chief. How many ballpark permits does the town issue for assembly? Ballpark.
I can't even give you that. I don't know.
A couple hundred? A lot?
Yeah.
That's a lot of inspections.
Well, and don't forget, it's not just for permits of assembly. There's inspections for fire sprinklers. There are inspections for fire alarms. There are inspections for propane. If you install propane at your house, there's an inspection for that. There are inspections for life safety today and tomorrow for our fire prevention officers doing two foster home inspections. These inspections, it's not just permit of assembly. When we're dealing with permit of assembly, it's places that are 50 people or more. So they require a permit of assembly. I want to say that there's 73, but I could be wrong on that. When it comes to the construction, throughout the phases of the construction, there's inspections to be done then. During rough-in, during sprinkler setup, during fire alarm setup. So there's a lot more inspections than just permit of assembly.
So that's a lot. And fire prevention, do you have a ballpark revenue of how much that department brings in?
Well, it's funny you ask, because on February 12th, we initiated new fees, thanks to the Board of Selectmen. And last year we took in a total of about $4,500. This year, since the generation of the new fees, actually I'm going to read it to you so that I don't get it wrong, $19,717 to date. And in January, up to February 12th, we made $425 for revenue. This year, we're at $19,000. Based on what we know for work that's coming, we're going to break $21,000 this year.
Oh, excellent. That's all I have, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm glad to see that Tim likes all these advances in the prevention. But being in business at the beach, I understand the pressure on you guys to get the things done.
Sir.
And you did a great job, and I was a benefit of it. But you also, by doing the other person's job, the prevention job, I'm sure your duties and stuff were put aside.
Yes, sir.
So I think it's great that it got done, but I find that we do have a serious need for a full-time prevention officer so that your job can be fully implemented. So thank you for what you did. You helped us out get through a bad time. We had an issue in the town, and I think we just keep moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jerry?
Yeah, part-time wages.
Yeah, yes.
Chief. I look at what you spend year-to-date, and I annualized it. And then I look at the last 4 years, and your request for 2016 looks about $7,000 higher.
$7,000 higher? We haven't finished the year yet, So she's still getting paid. She's my part-time secretary is the part-time wages.
I know, but I annualized her wage through 12 months, which and it comes out $13,000.
I don't think
and
she was there all 12 months.
She wasn't. No, she came in February 9th. So she started later. She wasn't paid until, I believe, February 16th would have been her first paycheck. So we're missing 6 weeks there.
Yeah, it's still, it doesn't, you know.
The way she's budgeted is for 20 hours a week at the rate that's in the union contract for that position, and then times the 52 weeks, so.
There you go.
I didn't annualize out what she's been paid this year, but I do know that when you look at the detail that she is budgeted for 20 hours for 52 weeks at her hourly rate in the union contract.
So and this is what the 22,558 is?
Yes.
Correct.
There you go.
Does she get a vacation? She gets a vacation too, I would think.
After the 6 months.
That's all in here?
Correct.
I don't know. That's what the wage
is. Personnel,
anyway.
Right?
Yes.
Sorry?
The pension costs would be in the personnel.
No, I didn't ask about that.
There's no pension costs because it's a part-time position.
So this would be the 20 hours a week throughout the 52.
Correct.
Weeks. All right.
Well, in that figure, Jerry, you're missing 4.5 months worth of work.
Right.
Because that's only through
October, yes.
Right.
On here it's through September, yes. Right. He was looking at his October finance. Yeah, you're right.
Correct.
You didn't have January, you didn't have half of February, and you're not reflected.
December, November, and October.
So 4.5 months.
Right.
Well, no, this is the part-time wage here is.
Why are we still talking
about it?
If
you were annualizing it,
we got the
missing 6 weeks would skew that number.
Right.
All right, so it would be higher. I'm not excited about that.
Okay.
Thanks.
What I had.
But there's a warrant article discussion on that anyway, because that's a move to move full time on that secretary, right?
That's true.
So we'll have further conversation on that later, Jerry.
Well done.
All right. Any other questions on this section? I just want to make a comment. We are being more effective following up on what Tim said, but having worked with a lot of businesses in this town in the past, I'll echo a little bit of what Chuck is saying too, because it doesn't take much to take your attentions away from the inspections. I don't know that I really want my fire chief out there doing inspections. I really think I want an inspector out there doing inspections and have you free to run your department. And there is a lot of work out there. There are a lot more units out there. And I don't know if it's fully appreciated how many tiers of inspections go on with construction and everything else that goes on, and how one person is charged with doing all that to begin with. It's a big task, all right? And I just want to add that to it, that you've managed to do what you do. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
All right. But I do not think that anybody here should take that for granted in looking at what the needs of this department are. I know you want to do a rebuttal.
No, I want right? I want to actually agree with you.
Thank you.
I think that you've done a fine job.
Thanks, sir.
And it shouldn't be taken for granted, and I don't. You've done a fine job.
Thank you,
I look
sir.
Forward to you continuing to do a fine job. And I would certainly think that while some people might not believe the fire chief should be doing inspections, I think the fire chief should get his hands dirty as much as possible while not neglecting his duties. Moreover, I don't want to see my fire chief or my firemen out there shoveling snow. And I think that's even more important. So,
point taken.
Point well taken. Can we go on to the next section?
I have one comment on this. On the fire inspection warrant article. Is the warrant article stressing the number of inspections?
We're not doing warrant articles.
We're not going to talk about the warrant article.
No, I know, but when he drafts his warrant article up, will it have quantification in it that really amplifies what we've talked about here in terms of the number of inspections?
Jerry, you can expect it.
I'm going to move on to training, which is three lines long. Let's not take an hour.
Thank you, ma'am.
So this also encompasses medical services for which we are required on new hires. We have to send them through medical. It's an expensive process, as anybody knows who has had any medical treatment. It's important that we find any problems so that we can stem them off. And then if nothing else, we want to make sure that we're hiring a healthy individual. This year, we've already hired one. We are looking at hiring two more by year's end. We've spent that money already. We're anticipating hiring a third firefighter early part of next year. This line item is barely going to cover medical for if we do have another firefighter vacancy. Additionally, if there are any type of reviews that need to go on, that's done there. Training and recruitment, that's gone up. My recruitment costs have been a lot this year. As I told you, we have had a lot of change. With the new fire, with the new emergency medical services officer, the fire captain, and the fire lieutenant, tests were involved. These tests are run by third-party agencies, run from the New Hampshire Fire Academy, so we have to pay for it, similar to what Chief Sawyer talked to you about for promotional processes. So in doing so, there's a cost associated with that. I also in here have training, which I have been, you know, we've been trying to support for years, especially this is all fireside training. We haven't had the appropriate level of training for the new technologies that exist. As I had put in the email, we're looking at hybrid vehicles. If you imagine how many are out there between Nissan and Honda and Toyota and Tesla, we have all of these new technologies we have to learn, because if they get into a car accident, we're going to be dealing with them from perspective of getting somebody out. We have to know how to do that. Solar panels on a roof, I put in there. It changes our operation significantly, and if you look left and look right, everybody's putting solar panels on the roof. There's a lot of technology that's gone on. There's a lot of changes that have occurred. NIST has been doing new studies, scientific studies on fire suppression. Well, that requires education. We have to bring that in the department. We have to have the people sit down. We have to have the proper training. So you see an increase in the line items here for that purpose. I also have requested next year moving forward fire officer training. We have never given that the due diligence. And it's really important because we have two brand new positions that were created, and I anticipate in the next 3 to 5 years, we're going to see move up. I need the people to be educated. As the world's changing, we have to make sure that we're sustaining this education.
Jerry?
Yeah, this the live fire training that you delineate in your rationale.
Yes, sir.
What does that cost to do?
What does it do?
No, what does it cost to do that training?
Well, that depends on how you do it. So I have a warrant article for the first time for four groups to go
this year. You have
that'll be right
in 2016.
$22,000. Okay. Now the live fire training costs that I have to bore later that are different are
2016.
Yep. Yeah. That's for the cost of the use of the drill yard. So there's an associated cost there. There's an instructor. Where we're going right now, we have two selections. We have Concord, which is the New Hampshire Fire Academy, and we have Guilford, which is using a place that they have out in their DPW yard. It's a container lot that they built up. It's a wonderful facility.
Yeah.
However, they have to bring in personnel because they're running a pumper for us so that we have water. They have personnel to staff it and to stop the fires and work as support. So that costs money. That's why I put it in the line item there.
How much is it?
Well, 22 grand to send four groups. If it's a daily occurrence, it's $400 for the use of the day. It is $200 for the instructor. So each time we go,
it'll be. And what was your plan? How many times are you going to go?
Next year, I want to send four groups. They've never all been as a group.
Four groups.
Right, which is $22,000 total.
Okay, and your warrant article is for what?
That.
Okay.
Right.
So when you talk live fire in here, you've got that.
What you're seeing is an explanation of what's going on there.
Okay.
Right, and I do
but
have.
You're
that
handling it with the warrant.
That's true, except for the drill yard fees, which you see is $1,500.
Okay.
Because that's coming out of my line item.
All right, I got that. Okay.
As it stands, just so you know, we've been doing it two times. We've had live fire training out there with the off-duty groups. We have pro time, which is professional development time. The firefighters are allowed to select the class, whether it's the New Hampshire Fire Academy. They selected to do 8 hours at the burn building. It's not every group, and they're not functioning as a group. My goal is to get them there as a team so that they can work as a team. That's
that makes sense. So the $1,500, that's a one-time shot?
That's for the year. That's for, no, that's for the
spread. How many trips would that make, or what?
Four
trips. It's $1,500.
Right.
Four trips. Okay. My concern here is that you're doubling your historical spend rate.
Yep.
You know, year to date, you've, your actual year to date is 11,600, and if you annualize that out, it's 13,500. And your last 4 years averaged 16,780, and now you're asking 35,653.
I can't speak to the time that I wasn't here, but I can tell you that on March 12th, I'll have been here 4 years,
yeah.
and they have never received the training that I feel is essential. And some of this training that has gone unfilled right now is going to cause a safety concern for me moving forward. If my guys have to work on a Nissan Leaf and there's a situation where they're going to be around battery power 600 volts, they have to know how to do it.
Yeah.
If I don't bring them that training, then I failed. So I need to bring this training. It's
trying to get it
long.
One step here in a hurry, I guess.
Well, we've been trying for years, and this is the first line item that's cut in every session that we move through. Training gets cut first. Mm-hmm. So I can't. I have to bring it forward to you with this because we've been cutting it for so long that now it doesn't exist, and now we're in a vacuum.
I want to throw something in here while you're going through this. Chief Ayotte's predecessor was always commended for holding a very strong, very tight budget with almost no increases for a number of years. And I think eventually that does catch up to you, that you fall behind.
Yeah.
And when you put the growth of the community and some of the new challenges of the community out here, the new technologies out there that you mentioned, we went down the list, as well as the height of buildings out there, that I don't think that this is unjustified. I think it's actually, I think it's catch up for what didn't happen in previous budgets.
Well, Miss Chairman, Madam Chairman,
mm-hmm.
if you look at training, he's only 38% year to date through October with this year's budget.
Mm-hmm.
38% spent with this year's budget, mm-hmm. 015. And that was a total of 29,000 he was budgeted, and he spent 11,274. So what I'm saying is he's not spending the money he's given this year.
So, Mr. Zanoy, if I could just answer that for a moment here, I would like to tell you that in August we were given direction from the town manager to rein in spending. And then in October we were told to stop spending. Actually, I think it was September, right, Mr. Wolf?
Yes.
Stop spending. So we did. And I can tell you that beginning in August, if you ask the people who work with me right now, I put in austerity measures that would make the Greek government pale, okay? We haven't done anything extra because we were told not to.
I see.
So the reason that we haven't is because there's no money out there. We know that, right? And it's not just me. Let's face it. DPW's feeling it, police feeling it as well. We've maintained this budget and the low cost right now because I've ended up, I stopped paying tuition on classes. So if they want to go to a fire academy class and there's a tuition associated with it, in October I stopped paying tuition for that. They can still go and get the hours, but I can no longer fund the tuition.
I hear you. But the sad part about that is we'll probably finish the year $500,000 to the good.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, just a quick clarification. When you say four groups get to go to these live fire burns, which sound like are both pretty close to an hour away, how many times does the individual firefighter get to go? I mean, you say four groups. Do they get to go more than once? Or
no, so four groups. I have group one, group two, group three, group four, right? And each one of those is led by a captain. And there's a lieutenant and the rest of firefighters. That team functions every day for 24 hours, and then they work 48 hours a week, right? So that team responds to all of the emergencies that day. It's my goal to take them, that one group of firefighters, bring them up to the burn building so that they can actually experience live fire. And when we say live fire, I know Mrs. Woolsey has a hard time with live fire because she thinks people are shooting at her. But when it comes to live fire, we're actually burning pallets and straw, and there's real smoke, real heat. There's conditions that would simulate a real fire. So they're crawling around, they're doing search and rescue, they're doing extinguishment and suppression, and they're doing overhaul, all of the techniques that they would have to do on a fire ground, but they're able to work as a team. We've had a lot of change. I've already demonstrated that to you. When you look at that, as a new teammate, you have to be able to practice a little bit, and you have to practice with the team that you're there with. So four groups, each individual firefighter will go with their group.
Okay.
So, that's
so that covers your whole department to go get the same training.
Absolutely. And it's the first time that will ever have been done.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
I just have one
quick one.
That place in Gilpin, I've been through there for the fire training, and it's a pretty phenomenal.
It's unbelievable what they did.
I was pretty amazed at what they could do and how they can recreate. So.
Yep. And you know,
I can see it being
credit goes
well
to the Guilford
it.
Fire Department.
Anyone else? All right, moving on. Communications.
Okay.
Simple.
No issues.
Should be simple. It's zero.
Yep.
Zero increase, no issues with me.
Then I think we can move on to repair services.
Oh, wonderful.
Next.
Well, Jerry's satisfied. I guess we all are.
There you go.
Well,
didn't have any gas in it.
Yeah, there's no gas in communications.
A lot of hot air.
That is fire stations and building, right?
Oh, yeah. We need a little discussion on this.
Vehicle maintenance is, I got a comment on that, but the chair belongs to the chair.
I think that this is a self-explanatory component of the budget. We have OT wages. Our fire engines are unable to be repaired at Hampton Fire Rescue. We have to send them out. When we do, we're sending them to highly qualified professionals that are going to be working on the pump. They're going to work on the engine. They're going to work on all parts of it. When it comes to the ladder truck, the hydraulic equipment, they're able to deal with all of that. To get them to the places that they need to go, I need to hire a firefighter to do the drive, or one of us, both of us, have gone out of town to pick up equipment. And that's not necessarily the best idea either. Yeah. So the overtime wage line item is for that purpose. The diesel fuel that you see right there, the addition was made by the town manager, and I do have a note on that if you'll give me a moment. So the diesel fuel used for the bucket truck has been moved to suppression, which you already knew that was last year.
That's diesel, right?
Yeah, sir.
It was moved.
So what vehicle do we have on this particular line here that the town manager added in?
I do believe that that's still representing the bucket truck. That's the same cost as the bucket truck.
So
that's what we've been using for fire.
No cost on that line?
That's actually been returned to the other line.
All right.
Vehicle maintenance, the costs there, you know, when we look at doing vehicle maintenance, we're not dealing with a bicycle. We're dealing with significant pieces of equipment, and we have to bring it to professional services. If you've ever had your car go into Honda Barn or, you know, Commonwealth Toyota, you're paying $85.
Labor rates, it's a big deal.
Absolutely. And when we were just discussing it today, 2 years ago, it was $75 an hour. Mm-hmm. And now we're up over $100 an hour.
Where do you
for
take it,
skilled labor.
Chief?
For repair services, we go to Minuteman.
Where is
in
that?
Walpole. Right. And for pump services, we go to Vassalboro, Maine.
And where is that?
Vassalboro, Maine.
What?
Vassalboro.
Where is Vassalboro?
Where is that?
Maine.
I know it's Maine, but whereabouts in Maine?
You take a left on Lafayette Road, and then you want the direct.
Keep going.
Yeah, keep going.
I think I've heard of Vassalboro one time before in my life.
Go to Augusta and take a right.
Must be a little dinky town.
I've got to tell you, though, we're getting top-notch service. This is the best pump mechanic in the whole... We're actually purchasing, as you know, last year we had a warrant article for a pump, and we're purchasing a Pierce pump, which engine one is a Pierce pump. Pierce sent equipment to our pump guy up in Vassalboro to test because he's that highly qualified. Hey, try to see what you can do with this. That's how qualified he is. He's the best pump repair we have. Mm-hmm. So there's no doubt. When we get it back, we know that our truck's going to function.
I'm going to ask you a question that's a little off the path. What else is in this town besides your repair facility?
Not much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Now, I know we have new equipment in recent years, but this line is going up.
This line is going up, yep.
Do you anticipate, I know we're looking at, you know, the end of September's figures here at almost 70,000. Do you anticipate going over that 110 from last year?
We are. Well, we're actually holding on work right now because of the spending situation that we're under. We have a generator problem on engine 3. Initial costs and figures are $8,000 to repair. We have a Wilbert light tower that needs to be repaired. We're looking at about $4,000. I believe it was close to that for repair. These are large ticket items, you know, and we're actually holding on work right now because of our concerns with the budget.
Now, that generator, what would happen if that generator went?
It did go.
It did go.
Have to repair it. We're getting extra quotes to make sure that we're getting the best price. It takes care of all the lighting from the truck, power equipment, anything that we might plug in, hand tools, whatever it might be on the side of the highway. If we have a car that's been rolled over and we need lights, or we also have an extension cord that we bring into the house where we use lights, because generally speaking, if there's a fire, we cut power to the building, so we need to see what we're doing. We bring in hand lights, so we bring in D lights, so we can see, we can illuminate the area.
All right, so excuse my ignorance.
No, that's fine. I'm
not... How can you get by without it?
Oh, okay, 121. Right.
I think that'd be critical. I think
it is critical. We just can't say, okay, well, for $8,000, we're going to go buy a new generator. So we have to get the best price. That's where we are right now.
Yeah, but with the absence of that working generator,
the pump still works.
Is there a backup on it?
Not on that piece.
So that's just not working, and you don't have these things to function right now?
On that piece. That's engine 3.
Okay.
Who's engine 2?
Huh?
They'll have to use engine 2 to respond.
Mm-hmm. And we have engine 1, engine 2, well, and engine 4 also.
Why do we have all this equipment if it doesn't work?
Well, not all of it works all the time, mm-hmm. every day. No. Some of it has to help the others.
It seems to me, it's just my opinion, that if we go out there and we've purchased these things because we need them, that we should keep them working.
Totally agree.
Fully.
And I got to tell you, between the town manager and the board of selectmen, they fully support that as well. I've had nothing but support in that.
Right.
So we're just making sure that we do it with due diligence.
But yet you're still on hold and you have a non-working engine 3.
Because we
got to
do it with due diligence. We have to do it right by purchasing policy as well.
Okay. I won't say any more about that. Sonny?
Yeah. I got a dumb question.
Then Scott?
I like dumb questions, sir.
Cost a lot of money, right?
Say again?
Buying new engines costs a lot of money.
Yes.
Is there any coordination between the neighboring towns where one town will buy one piece of equipment, you'll buy another? Because you help each other all the time.
Yeah,
no.
then they use Hampton.
As far as coordination, every town has a different purchasing policy. Every town has a different mechanism to do that. And there's never been an alignment on when your piece was purchased, my piece was purchased. So at failure or at end of life, there's no coordination there. So to answer your question, no.
Yeah, it answers the question. It's a shame because, you know, the towns can't afford to keep buying, you know.
Of course. Pumpers are 600,000. Ladders are 800,000.
Ladders are 1,000,005.
Okay. No, 1,000,005.
1,000,005. No. You better keep that one working a long time. Just kidding.
We're doing our best.
Well, you can build another. If you send an engine to another town, you can probably build a gas to that town, right?
Scott?
Yeah, I just want to understand something. If you take through October and you annualize it, that vehicle maintenance would be $96,000,
right,
for the year. You know, the budget was $110,000.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're asking for $121,000, which is a bit ahead of where it's been in past years. And it sounds like part of that problem is that we're deferring maintenance. You need to do some maintenance this year. You know you're going to have to do it.
That line item will be expended by the end of the year. The vehicle maintenance that you're seeing that's remaining right now,
yeah,
that will be expended by the end of the year.
Up to $96,000 or all the way to the $110,000?
$110,000, that'll be expended. Based on the fact that I have a $8,000 generator and potentially a $4,000 repair to a light tower,
okay,
that's gonna eliminate. That's another $12,000. 96 and 12, we're looking at 108. So
it hasn't been. I don't want to get into town management, but it hasn't been the town management decisions to curtail your vehicle
not on
maintenance.
Emergency spending. They've given no, but we have to do it the right way too. This has been 2 weeks now that we've been dealing with a debted generator, and we're getting prices. It takes a little while to do that.
Yeah, it's only been 2 weeks.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Chief.
Yes, sir.
Anybody else?
Repair services.
Okay, Jerry.
My only comment on that is that you're asking for $121,500, which is really the same amount you asked for last year, identical to what you asked for last year. It was defaulted to $110,000.
That's true.
But the rationale was that labor costs are going up.
That's true.
But the labor costs in this budget here is identical to the labor cost last year, $33,000.
Where are you seeing $33,000?
On the top of page 31, outside labor, $33,000.
Right. The requested budget last year was the same as the requested
That's
budget
right.
for 16.
Right. And we were defaulted.
I know, but what I'm saying is...
Just like the fireside, I'm anticipating what the labor costs will be. I can't guarantee it.
Right.
So this is best guess based on experience.
But it was the same cost last year, 33, right?
I'd be happy to.
In 2015, it was 33.
And in 2015, you just said that the requested amount was 121, was the same as the requested amount for 2016.
Right, right. What I'm saying, the labor.
So it would make sense if the both amounts were the same that were requested in 15 and 16, then the labor being the same would also make sense.
Okay, but there's a comment down here, though, that.
The guidance that
increase
we were
was due to increase in labor cost at the service agents.
Yes.
And, but that, the and this is an R16 book, so.
Yes, but that's because we're speaking of the increase from the 110,000, which is the default amount,
correct,
to the 121. So we're just reminding you that in 15, we increased that line because of labor costs,
right,
and we're doing the same thing in 16 because it didn't happen in 15.
One
Tim, then Stephen.
Yeah, we jumped over a little quick for me going to repair services. I have to go back one section here and inquire about our favorite account, which is radio maintenance.
Radio
maintenance. No radios here.
Yeah, under communications.
He's going back into another.
Oh, you're going back.
That you can't give me the bum's rush, Jerry.
Where is radio maintenance?
Communications. Section before under communications.
Here? Or radio maintenance.
4310.
Well, Tim, before we go backwards, let's finish this section,
yeah,
and we'll go backwards.
All right.
Just anybody else on this section other than Stephen?
Just one thing for clarification. So the generator on engine 3 has been down for 2 weeks?
Maybe a little more.
Okay. I think that needs to be clarified because it hasn't been down for 2 months or 3 months.
No.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
And you're getting it fixed.
We are.
There. I just wanted to make sure that people don't think that we're not fixing
certainly
things.
Not.
Okay, good. Thank you very much, Chief.
Thank you, sir.
Now
can
you
I go backwards now?
Yeah.
Radio maintenance, suffix 4310, Jerry. We have an actual as of 9:30, of course, of $5,391. And we're budgeting $12,500. You seem to be budgeting that again for next year, $12,500.
Yes, sir. You know that we were giving guidance.
I know you
guidance.
Spoke about a freeze.
Well, we were also giving guidance to come in flat with the budget. I can tell you that right
now. Well, it doesn't mean you couldn't come in lower on some line item.
Costs aren't going lower.
Well, it seems to be on radio maintenance.
It's not.
Well.
We're also in process because we've got a couple of problems going on that have been readily identified through poor communications on the fire ground and other, whether on a highway or whatever it might be. We're unable to get all of the transmissions that we need, and that's we're feeling that we're going to replace circuitry right now. That's going to be a stopgap. We're looking at doing an upgrade to all of our radios. I am going to be seeking grant funding for that. I know that that's a major cost. There has been no major change in the radio system since at least 2007 or longer. Our hand radios, our portable radios that we wear in our jackets and that we talk on, they're exceedingly old, and it's costing us well over $125 per radio just to get it serviced now. Just a radio mic, lapel mic, which you see us wearing up here so we can speak. We carry it in our pouch so we're able to walk hands-free. To replace that is over $90. I think it's $110. It's $110 to replace one radio mic. So the costs are not going down at all. I can assure you of that. We haven't been spending where we need to on that because we've been under a freeze.
Tim, the average over the past four years was $12,353. If you annualize this year into that, it's $11,176. They're asking for $12,000.
I understand. There's a problem, Scott, with that analysis. It's often the same problem that exists elsewhere. The radio maintenance came up last year, because I believe the fire department was actually spending money from radio maintenance for purposes other than radio maintenance, as was the police doing the same thing.
Can't speak to the police.
I understand. I'm not asking about the police. I believe it was the fire department was doing some lawn cutting or something like that. I can go back to the videos and find out if we really need to be clear on the point. My concern is that when we look at historic numbers, Scott, as you had mentioned, and they look like consistent.
Mm-hmm.
You have to actually look at, was that actually expenditures appropriate for that particular line or subline?
We have no idea.
That question, well, that's an assumption that is a bit dangerous to make.
Yeah.
And
we can get into that at another time, because it's more of a global issue than it is specific to this line item or to the fire department itself. But I see 5391 as of September 30th. that they're actually expended in this line item, which is, of course, less than half of the budget amount.
Mm-hmm.
Yet yours, yeah, as of 9:30.
That's going to change.
Three quarters of the way through.
That's already changed.
But I accept the freeze as a reason for it being artificially.
Even with the freeze, we've had emergency repairs of portable radios. That number's already changed.
The freeze doesn't apply to these kind of devices because they're part of your emergency equipment.
That's true.
So the freeze doesn't apply to this, the subline item.
No, but there's also additional equipment that goes along with that, with communications, with radios. We had we spent a lot of our summer in the radio tower at Falcone Circle because there was a server that needed to be replaced, and there was also a backup battery power. I believe it's UPS, UBS. I'm not a computer guy, but that backup battery power had to be replaced two times. So there's a cost associated with that each time that comes out of radio maintenance.
UPS.
So there's a lot of costs that are associated with, other than, I'm talking to you about portables because that was
those purchases to me suggest a capital expenditure as opposed to a maintenance expenditure.
I would agree with you when I talk about the global changeover of radio.
Or a UPS device, when you're replacing a device, is it different than maintaining a device?
The system itself stays functioning, but if you have...
I understand the end purpose is the same.
Right, but it's not a capital expense if it's, you know, it's not like buying a fire engine.
Of course, because it's not a fire engine.
Right. But it is our lifeline.
I understand readily the importance of it. I'm not questioning that at all. I'm just trying to point out that when we see the word maintenance, it's not always actually maintenance we're talking about. Sometimes we're talking about actual replacement.
Parts, right?
Which is, no, not parts, but actual... whole units.
Right. Well, if you have
as
a computer
in the UPS
at home,
device you were talking
right,
about.
But if you have a computer at home, you have a battery backup device that's on the floor, and that device, if that gets replaced, that's part of the maintenance. They don't last forever, and if you're looking
battery
at
battery backup is not a device, but the battery backup as a UPS, uninterrupted power supply,
right.
And I buy another uninterrupted power supply
to replace the one that failed.
Whether it's
that's maintenance.
Whether no, it's actually a unit replacement.
I think we're having.
And so when we see the word maintenance, we have to look carefully at exactly how that's being used. Okay?
Well, I think it's subject to interpretation.
That needs.
Well, that's exactly the point I'm making.
Well, maybe the line needs a different description.
What I'm seeing is an expenditure here that is not is. Was not subject to freeze.
All right.
It's less than half as of September 30th, less than half of the budgeted amount.
They say September
30th. All right.
So am I to imply from that there's been some deferred maintenance going on?
No.
All right.
So how did we come up with this number? So because it was the same as last year?
We were level funded, right?
Yeah.
I can't accomplish everything that I need this year. I can't accomplish everything I need this year with the forethought of changing the entire radio system. I'm not doing that here. So instead, I'm maintaining the radio maintenance because this is the expenditures that I know. So what I'm telling you right now is that the repairs that have had to happen have happened. Like I told you, the number that y'all looking at is inaccurate. Yeah. It has gone up already. There are still two, I believe we still have at least two handsets that are out.
Three.
Yeah. And then there are portable radio situations that we're dealing with. Mobile radios, which is the one with the heads inside the vehicles, that we're still currently dealing with.
I'm sorry to have to do this, but Jerry slipped up on his normal. The historical doesn't reflect your budget on this one, so I need to do. I need to back
so
him up.
So we dinged Mr. Zanoy. How's that?
Wait a minute now. I agree with Scott. The last 4 years is $12,353, and he's budgeting $12,502.
Yeah, but as of 9:30, he's like way under.
Gentlemen, I think it's time to move on. All right.
All right. A building.
Make one quick comment.
Not if it's on that subject.
Okay, so we're moving on.
Do you have another dumb question, sir?
I was going to suggest that we considered using cell phones.
For?
Radio.
No.
No.
And I'll tell you why. Immediately no, and then the long answer no. Immediately no, because there's no way to guarantee that we'll have a signal. This town's a very difficult. If you have any type of carrier that's other than this one or that one, you go to the center of town, you can't get service. You go to the beach, you can't get service. Additionally, there's no means for that for firefighters to get out and dial and call when they're in the midst of a fire. They need a radio communication. So push the button and talk.
You got a warrant article.
We're not doing warrant articles right now.
Fire stations and buildings.
Okay, fire stations and buildings, page OBS 3.
Thank you.
All right.
13.
OBS what?
13.
13, not
13.
Focused. Okay, OBS I want to focus 13. On this a little bit because we're seeing some hefty increases in this category.
Yep.
We are.
Worth talking about.
All right.
Yep.
Electric.
Yep.
Start with that one.
As I discussed with you last time I saw you, we are now funding two new 10,000 square foot buildings. We have an addition that houses administration and fire alarm as well as personnel, and we have a new fire station at the beach. These the electricity to take up 20,000 square feet is greater than the small facility that we had prior to on 141 Econet and the very small facility that we had at 64 Ashworth Ave. The increases that I have put in here, and I told you and you know very well that I was instructed to come in level funded. Mr. Wilk actually minced no words when he said, come in level funded, don't give me anything. I broke the rule, and I'm hoping that he's going to let me stay here. But I came in, the biggest increases that I had were for utilities because they're known costs. And last year when I sat in front of you, I told you the same thing. I know my costs are going up this much. I have to have that money. This year, when we're talking about all of the, you haven't spent this, you haven't spent that line item,
it is.
You can see where it goes. Okay, and I'm trying not to get to the expenditures too much here, but at the end of the day, I know what my electricity costs. I did receive an email question regarding this about the annualized changeover on that. However, I can tell you that I had a discussion with Mr. DeRozier as late as this afternoon, and we discussed the times that he negotiated a rate for the fire department, and it was a rate change per kilowatt hour. The rate change that he negotiated was sometime late spring, and I do believe that he told us about it in June. Then, as I told you before, I prepared this budget in May. I presented it to the town manager in June. We reviewed it in July. There were no changes then, and so the rate had come down, not substantially, very minute. In September, he renegotiated. That rate went back up. We're at 7.6 cents per kilowatt hour, I do believe he told me today. So that's an increase. So moving forward.
What is the percentage increase? What is the 31%. Percentage increase? Going forward,
31
for the new rate.
Yeah, for the kilowatt hour. Because I mean, I'm sitting here looking at this, and at the end of September, you're three quarters of the way through the year.
Right.
So that would translate to roughly about 33,000, right? Yeah. 44,000.
We haven't hit cold yet, so we're going to be running the furnaces throughout. We haven't hit. Well, I mean, it's dark now at 4 o'clock. So we need to keep the lights burning longer. This isn't able to be annualized as
right,
well.
Right, but that's like another whole quarter in there. So,
and that was like, also, like I told you, this was also before the rate change. I do believe that you're going to see this come out at 38, not 33.
At 38.
At the end of the year.
But you're looking for 44.
Because I also know now, today, that it's gone up again in September for next year, for 2016.
Can I ask you to furnish us through me?
I can do the best I can.
The rate change in the electric rate by percentage and the date that kicked in. You said it was.
Ask the Energy Committee.
It was in the fall or late summer?
The new rate moving forward. And I don't know how long. I think that's only till November. This fluctuates too, you know. This is out of my hands. I don't negotiate that.
So when will
the
next rate change be coming in?
Don't know, ma'am.
All right. Is that something that they might have?
Maybe.
All right. It would help me to know when that rate change increased, all right, when it's due to exit.
Right.
We are seeing, well, fuel costs have gone down.
I am seeing everywhere that
electric costs are rising.
They are.
And
there was also a commercial rate change, and that was outside of my purview last year, I believe. And any homeowner also had a residential from the power companies. So they felt that right away. We felt it too, but if you remember, I'm on a default budget. So all of the rate increases we didn't get to do. So
it's just in this particular line, it feels a little heavy at 44,000, but if it can be substantiated by the rate change and that can be distributed. So if you have that and can furnish me with that, I'll make sure that the committee gets that as well.
Okay.
Thank you. Nick?
Under electric, and this probably goes for all utilities, just for clarification, you guys get up in the middle of the night, go out to calls and stuff. The parts of the building of the fire departments that are not in use all the time, are they lit up?
No.
Or are they on some sort of like meter where they automatically conserve power, doing the best you can to
doing the best, power. Right. So my father's finger, I refer to it, right? Everybody walks through the room and you shut off the lights. Your father did that, my father did that, I do it. So you shut off the lights when you're not in the room. We have in the new stations, we also have motion detectors. So if you walk down the hallway, the lights come on. If you go in the bathroom, the lights come on. That was part of the deal to help rein in the costs on electricity. Additionally, if there is an alarm, and whether it's medical or fire or however it might be, for the alarm to go out, it goes out over intercom, the dispatcher will push a button, turn on the lights, so that whoever's getting up to go do the call, they can see where they're going, the apparatus bay, that's lit up, so that occurs then. Okay. Generally speaking, our offices right now are dark, the hallway there is dark, administration's dark tonight. So,
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sonny, then Jerry.
I thought the town did a power purchase agreement for the fixed rate for all municipal buildings. You're talking utilities rates that are bouncing around, right? Because, you know, the town's looking at
the energy committee
doing a solar array for the landfill, which will
outside of the
which
fire
will department. Cover all the municipal buildings. But no. I thought the town had a power purchase agreement with an Integra Constellation.
I'm going to defer to Mr. Welch on that one.
Because I see electricity is higher for most of the problem.
They do. They have the, you know, the DeRosher contract with
DeRosher.
Yeah.
Or at the end of it.
And the huge fluctuation in power costs even out of that contract in the winter.
Yeah.
That's just starting. It started in November and it'll run through February, March.
Yeah.
Just as your electric bill at home does. See, here, double in cost.
I Googled utility rates in New Hampshire, in Hampton.
Yep.
And it was very surprising to see what
rate, so.
What was that, Sonny?
You can get the rates, G2 rates on Unitil's website under commercial.
That's what I was looking for. I was surprised to see that in December of 14, the rates jumped 30%, and that would carry to like end of May. And the reason for that was that the gas demand goes up for the electric plants using gas generators as opposed to their own generators.
Actually,
so everybody was fighting for gas, the homeowners that use gas to heat their home, and those that are generating, the utility companies generating electricity fighting for gas.
Actually, Unitil buys six-month contracts off the grid, so they're not generating electricity.
Which also makes it harder to annualize it because the price fluctuation per kilowatt hour changes more than once a year.
No, I think twice a year it changes. It changes once in December and once
well,
a year.
Even still, it's hard for me to annualize it 18 months.
We need a calculation.
What happens is they need to go to the Utilities Commission and request an increase, and it's done at different intervals, and they're not always the same intervals. It's as the need exists for the utility companies, and usually they're granted with very little concern for the taxpayers.
If we saw rates per kilowatt hour and the number of kilowatt hours, we do our own math and we could see, that number comes up.
You're not going to be, it's a difficult thing to do. All I'm asking at this point is that we look at what the history was last year, get some feel for where we were going. Last year we had to do it with the gas. There's nothing finite. There's no place you can go for that answer. I work in a different state, and I will tell you, across the board, no matter what municipality it is, no matter what electric company they're using, we've already got increases built in for 2016 that have been passed in Massachusetts that will go into effect mid-year. Now, Massachusetts doesn't affect New Hampshire, but as one goes, usually the other goes. And having some historical perspective from a percentage standpoint of what the increase was and when it came in and when it expires will give us some idea. We can go forward from there. All right.
But my only concern would be that if this is underfunded again, then I would have to obviously take rub from Peter to pay Paul. And we've done that for an entire year. It's a very difficult place to be.
No, I understand.
Madam Chairman, I would also make a comment that the original budgeted request that he made last year was for $37,774,
right.
And it was defaulted down to $23,231.
Right.
So we took a beating on that particular line item there. And it looks like he's going to come in around that amount.
Right.
$37,000, $38,000
okay,
for this year.
this year.
Yeah.
And then
next year, something else.
As I said, you know, today when I was building this, I'm projecting out for December of 16. That's 18 months away.
Yes.
So.
So, I mean, if he had gotten that particular budget line item, we wouldn't be looking at 44,000 as being such a big jump.
Right.
But we're looking at it with respect to 23 instead of 37.
Well, going down to heating fuel.
Yes.
Are we using gas or oil on that?
Gas.
Yep. That explains that one.
Yep.
And any questions on that? Gas rates are going up. Water?
Water went up.
Is that the size of the stations and the actual use?
And also two sprinkler stations. Previously, the 140 Winnicunnet building as it existed was not sprinklered, and 64 Ashworth Ave was not sprinklered. We now have sprinklers in both. We're code compliant, I'm glad to say. You know, we're going into business of saying they must be code compliant. We're code compliant, but it also goes with an increased cost.
All right, moving down to building maintenance. These are new buildings.
They are new buildings, but we are now 2 years into them. A lot of the warrantied work, 1 year old, has been expired. Any of the maintenance that we must incur is going to be borne by the fire department. You can see that if you look at it, I had a encumbrance, I do believe, and that was for floor maintenance, because on our taking over of the new properties, one thing that wasn't done for the VCT tile, which is the vinyl tiles, they had never been cleaned and finished with a top coat finish. Mm-hmm. So we had that done. We encumbered money. That just got done a month ago. I do believe it was a month ago. So we've now got finish on all the floors to help maintain that. Moving forward, that's going to be a yearly expense to maintain it. Otherwise, we're going to end up needing to replace tiles on the floor.
Was it tiles?
Yeah, VCT tile, yeah. So there are numerous other things that occur. We still have the old building, 140 Winnicunnet, that there's maintenance that goes on in that one. The heating, especially for the apparatus bays, there's an increased cost with everything that we're doing. So this also encompasses all of the cleaning supplies and the products that we use for that, toiletries, whatever it might be. You need toilet paper, you need paper towels. So
is this also subject to a little bit of a freeze? Is your
currently?
Yeah.
Except with toilet paper. That's an emergency.
No, but I mean, you were kind of frozen on some of the other stuff.
True.
Yeah, because you're underspent.
Stephen?
I'll
be here all week.
At the beach station, Chief, the tower, has the contractor found that leak yet?
No. Yes and no. So yes on the primary leak. So if you look at the fire station at the beach, we have a light tower, which is the circular windows. Immediately behind that, we have a radius roof. It's a metal roof. And then where the top roof comes into that light tower, there was a significant leak there. They identified that, they fixed it. There was another problem that created. They identified that, they fixed it. And for several weeks, we let the ceiling underneath dry. Anybody who's been down to that fire station knows that it's been roof rafters and joists, all open and vacant. On Tuesday next week, they're actually going to be putting up the cheesecloth and blowing in insulation. And then Wednesday and Thursday, they're going to be putting up the sheetrock for that portion. Now, as you continue up the stairs, where the windows actually are now, we're in the side light. That used to be, you know, that's the old hose tower and the older fire stations.
Right.
There's a leak under the windows that we're still having a problem identifying, but the Ekman Construction continues to work to identify it. They're doing all the work that's on them. They know
right.
that,
right.
And they continue to keep coming in. Next week, we start the process of repairing all of the ceilings. I anticipate that once we find this leak, that'll be solved rapidly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
I want another question on a tile. You're thinking we're going to have to do refurbishment on the tiles every year?
We're going to have to finish it. We're going to have to do the floors.
And that's $9,000?
No. Okay. Don't remember what the cost was.
Well, the encumbrance was $9,375. And you indicated that was...
$4,900, I think, was the encumbrance.
No, the encumbrance was $9,375. Building maintenance. And you kind of indicated that was primarily for the floors.
What's that? Yeah, for the floors, I only budgeted $2,000 because I know that that's a known cost.
Right.
So the way it's broken out.
Okay, so, I mean, we're not spending.
No, this is over everything. So duct repair, the furnaces need filters, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay. All right.
Okay.
So it's not it's the encumbrance was not simply for the floor tiles.
Don, I wish I could tell you offhand. I don't recall what the other one was.
But really, you had a $29,520 budget in you.
Which line item are you referring to, my friend?
Building maintenance.
Yeah, which line item, though?
Well, it was 300. The building main. Well, the what line item? The building.
6,300.
Yeah, 6,300. Yeah. Thank you, Steve.
Okay. All right, we are coming close to the end.
So you're underspent there, but it's basically.
That's true. The other thing that went up with the new buildings is the fire alarm, fire prevention side of things, right? We have to have them tested every year. Down at the beach station, we have an elevator. We have to have that tested every year. Sprinklers have to be tested every year.
Yeah.
So this has also increased our costs.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you should be able to build a precinct for that, right? The village district for the elevator?
No.
Why not?
Because it's not their building anymore.
Oh, but they're going to be using
they use it.
Yeah, the room.
Charge them for the rate of using it.
We'll bill them on use.
Chuck gets on and charge
them. There you go, Chuck. Thank you for showing up.
I think they do a tremendous job down there.
You mean like a coin-operated elevator?
There you go.
They're very great guests.
Okay.
Fortunately, there was a lot of negotiation, and we both made out, so we did. Okay.
Okay.
You both made out, but the taxpayers were left where?
I think the village district is a heavy taxpayer in the town.
I agree.
We are part of the town of Hampton.
Of course you are.
Absolutely. We're double taxpayers.
That's right.
Some of us a trip?
No, we're all double down at the beach.
Okay, moving on to pier maintenance.
I got a question about pier maintenance.
On pier. Jerry, you've had a question on everything. Anybody else want a chance?
I'll give somebody else an opportunity.
Let him do it. At least he hasn't passed gas tonight.
No, he promised on that one.
Okay, pier maintenance, you budgeted roughly
$5,000. Yeah, you're not seeing the close-up
like
costs
candy?
Yet.
You spent?
Hmm? You
okay.
Candy?
We had to close it for the winter, so we have to take care of the pier as it is. We have to take the water out. We have to take the electric, you know.
Okay.
So.
Question I have is this. Are there any projects been identified with respect to the pier? Have you looked at it? Have you inspected the pier? Are there any significant projects for the pier
maintenance, you mean?
Well, it says pier maintenance.
For large expenditures, I don't anticipate any in 2016.
So the last 4 years you've spent an average of $2,720, and you're asking for roughly $5,000.
$1,200, that would be one bollard, which is an electric light baller, to replace that would be $1,200.
Really?
And if that gets struck during coming in on high tide, if we're coming in with tide and current, and we strike a bollard, or if somebody else does, or if
a bollard, is that what
yeah,
it is?
Lighted bollard, so that we can see the pier at night, or if there's a lightning strike down there, if there's anything else, that would be eliminated.
Okay.
There's a lot of big price equipment that travels down there, and it's very large boats. If you've ever been out in the bay, you know that there's an awful lot of
We'll have to get the November run, and that'll help us further.
Okay.
December run. But right now,
you're
way underspend on that.
When he's finished.
Okay.
What you're saying?
That'd be related to the Hampton Navy.
Yeah,
you're gonna spend it.
We refer to it as Marine One.
Some of us in town refer to it as the Hampton Navy. You have a dock over there, right? Or some sort of launching place. You have a pier there.
Yeah.
Just talking so about can that. People like jump off it and go swimming, like they could off
safety.
The old Smith and Gilmore pier?
All right, Tim.
No, I'm asking. It's
well, Stephen's head is on Anna.
Could you ask that for me?
The pier. Is that not a state pier? That's not our pier, is it?
It's a public safety pier. It's ours, but we allow.
But didn't the state build that? It seems like, did we build that? I thought somebody else built it for us.
Federal funds.
Federal funds. Okay. So it is, but it is for the. It is the. It is the towns now. Okay. Okay.
But you will.
You
will see.
That's what I was mixed up about.
And marine patrol boats that will tie up there.
Okay, but I wasn't sure. I thought it was federal funds. Okay.
Jump off it.
Thank you very much.
Good job. Jump off it.
No,
sir.
No trespassing.
Chief, can we?
No trespassing. Thank you, sir.
What, the public is not allowed on that pier at any time, even just to go swimming?
No, actually, we do have a gate.
No diving off it, Timmy. You've been known to dive off it.
Well, it's cheaper than buying $4 million worth of marina just so you can jump off a pier.
Okay. Whoops.
Well, that's something for the voters to decide.
Madam Chair, I do believe...
Whoops. Whoops.
Whoops. You believe we ran out of lines.
Okay.
I have a follow-up.
All right. Are there any other questions before we conclude this tonight?
Oh, this is wonderful.
And we have fire hydrants to go over.
Okay.
Just
a quick comment. You know, I know you got those questions late yesterday.
Yes.
And you got the answer today. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Good
appreciate
job on
it.
That.
Appreciate
I apologize for the emails that went awry and that didn't get find a home.
Oh, thank you, Chief.
All right. Anybody with anything else on the fire budget? Jim?
Just to go back again, because I had to take some time to do some research. There was some maybe a misunderstanding, or maybe it's still a misunderstanding with me. Regarding the fire inspector warrant article that was mentioned as still being out there, I have referenced the November 9 Board of Selectmen's minutes, and it says quite clearly the selectmen do not support this article. In fact, you had two there. One was for a fire inspector vehicle for $40,000. Town Manager Welsh said he recommended that you do not appropriate this, and the selectmen do not support this. The next one was a fire inspector. Okay, so there is no warrant articles regarding fire inspector. I wanted to be clear that every one of the board members understand that. And for those viewers at home playing the home version, they can be corrected as well.
Thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
So the fire inspector will be funded where?
It was not approved as a warrant article.
It's not going to go in as a warrant article.
It's not going to go in as a warrant article.
Right.
It's not going in as a warrant article. It's not in the operating budget.
Asking Chief Ayotte.
Chairman has all the warrant articles that were approved. They've all been emailed to her.
Okay.
So the inspector's position, and that's my error and not okay. Following up.
So the inspector's position was not approved.
Will not be
in a warrant article. So does that mean that you will continue to be doing the inspections?
That means that Fire Prevention Officer Payne will be doing the lion's share and will continue to function as backup for fire inspection, fire investigation.
Spread thin again.
That's a shame. I wish that, I mean, there's still time, but I really wish that could be reconsidered. I mean, insofar as at least allowing the public and the taxpayers to decide, because I know there are a lot of people who would like to see that position. I rest my case on that one.
Yeah, I remember the conversation, Eileen, and they... The selectmen more or less said no new additions, and I think that was really across the board. They didn't want any new people necessarily.
That's right.
Which would add to the retirement liability, which is a big part of our budget right now.
Well, they've added new people on their own. I'm saying this is something that many people, not just one, but many, many people out there in the public have been asking about and requesting, and there has been a need. I'm just making a statement that it would be nice to see a warrant article and put it to rest. The public can decide for themselves whether they'd like to see the fire inspector position and fund it or not.
You've put it out before, right?
Yes, this is not the first year.
So I anticipate it'll be next year?
I look
forward to it because I agree. Based on the work you described earlier, it sounds like
there's certainly
a lot to do. Yeah, and a need for it.
All five selectmen were opposed to this warrant article.
I'm not speaking to the selectmen, I'm just speaking to myself.
I'm just speaking about the record.
Okay. I'm giving my opinion on this committee, looking at a budget.
What's next on
right,
the agenda?
Looking at money. We're not just here, all right, to cut things down.
Well, are you suggesting we should consider adding it?
That's what I'm asking. Excuse me one moment. I'm asking for reconsideration of that, maybe for discussion at review. I would have liked to have seen a warrant article for something new because we did ask that the budget line be held, and that's what the town manager went at doing and conveyed to their department heads and put
that.
New things. Excuse me, Tim. Let me finish.
Timmy, hold on.
And putting things into warrant articles that were new and letting the public decide what they wanted to spend their money on or not. All I'm saying is that here, what is reasonable and rational to spend money on, and it seems that we've had a need in manpower in this department, although we don't have a warrant article for that. And we've had a need for this fire inspector position that has been going on for a long time. And as I stated, and not to be redundant, but we have our fire chief acting as the fire inspector. To me, those are two different positions. And it seems that we still have the need. I'm sorry that the selectmen did not at least put that warrant article forward to let people decide. I think much more discussion is warranted on that position.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
As you pointed out, we can add this in to the budget if the budget committee wishes to.
Yes, we can.
The numbers that were put forth was 109,346 for the annual costs of the fire inspector. And the fire inspector's vehicle was supposed to be about $40,000. So that's the kind of numbers we'd be looking at. Although, that was the number, the annual cost that the town manager says, according to the draft minutes, you said, town manager said $109,346. But the actual line says fire inspector total cost $82,000. I think that may be because it's a partial year, but I'm not sure.
Oh, sir, that's, you're looking at the difference between salary and benefits.
Right. So as a budget committee, we have to look at the total cost.
Understood.
So the total
but
cost
the
82, would be 109.
You're looking at the difference between salary and benefits there. So
right. The 109 is salary and benefits, right? Yeah. So we'd have to be adding in basically 109,000 plus.
That's correct.
If we wanted to do it.
The 109,000 is salary and benefits.
That would be salary and benefits,
salary
I think.
Salary and benefits.
And then the something like $40,000 for a vehicle
well,
for it as well.
I wouldn't be talking
about no vehicle needed.
I think that
no
there is
vehicle
a vehicle,
needed?
Yeah. There, you do have a
one of the horses that we don't use.
All right, just food for thought. We don't always have to look to subtract. We can also look to add.
Yeah, I just wanted to give you the numbers, so if you guys want to digest it for further discussion, that's fine.
Okay.
I eagerly accept any additions.
So we're done with the fire?
We will give it full consideration, I expect.
Thank you, sir.
So these gentlemen
now, will you be representing the fire hydrant expense,
hydrant.
Which is kind of a moot point?
Yeah, not to me. I don't own them. And they're a private entity, so I can tell you where they are. I can tell you what they look like when we shovel.
You can have Fred wrap that one up on. Does anybody have any question on the fire hydrant expense? It is what it is.
It is what it is. It's another one of those fixed costs that I
just fixed.
Choke on. Cut it to rest. Yep, go ahead.
I thank you both gentlemen for joining us this evening.
Thank you all. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bringing us a good
have
budget.
A good night.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Good luck.
Thank you,
Chair. Sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but the truth is more important.
What?
We got it in fire inspector.
Take care, baby.
We'll deal with it.
You too.
Sorry to be the bad news.
Deputy.
Better
take
to
care.
You know, not be having a false information.
No, that's
all
right. I
seemed a bit upset with me in the fire. I'm sorry.
I'm upset with you all the time.
I have an
I mean, more than usual.
Okay.
You should get done gabbing with
Michael.
Yeah.
Before they go, I just wanted to try to get an answer on the default budget. I didn't
realize the default budget, right. We need to know when we're going to get that.
Fred,
Christy.
Before
yes.
you go,
yeah.
we have a question for you.
Default budget.
On the default budget.
On the what?
The default budget.
Yes. Default budget.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know when it, about what time, Fred? You know, a date?
No, I don't. It's got to be done. We know that. And we're still reviewing some, but we're worried about the insurance.
Yeah.
Well, can that be completed with the insurance as it stands? I know that you don't have a final figure, and we can adjust that at the end. Because the insurance figure will be whatever it is.
Well, the insurance figures will be what they're
exactly.
Going.
We have no control over that, or the default budget for that matter, and we realize
that. I understand that.
They will be adjusted. As they will be in the budget itself.
I'm responsible to give the select with the total budget. I don't have it.
There's a couple other things, too.
They have to vote it and to go back and redo the whole thing over again is a pain in the you-know-what. In order to change the default, they've got to do that. Go back and change go over the whole budget.
Well, if that was the case, then we wouldn't have the budget at all. We wouldn't have this either. I think we've waited long enough, Fred. We are... you know, getting to midway in December, and I really think, as a committee, we need the default budget.
Well, we'll see what we can do to get it to you, but I can't tell you when. I just don't know.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Good night.
Yep, good night.
Hey.
Hi, Kristen.
Michael, did you have a, was that it?
Well, I was just going to wait until we're out of earshot. I'm beginning to think we're getting so much BS in this room that I can't stand it. Between the audit and the default budget. And they said, you mentioned that the insurance rates are fixed, right? Well, if they're fixed, why are we $200,000 off on this year's budget?
I didn't say the insurance rates are fixed.
Well, they're...
But what I said is that we were all given a budget. The ball hasn't finally landed on the insurance rates.
Right.
For them to do the default budget, but that would also hold true for the budget. When right. those insurance rates land, your budget book is going to change.
That's true, but if you notice, this last year, the year we're in, they're off by $200,000. So
two different.
Even though you have the correct numbers, that doesn't necessarily mean the right amount ends up in the default budget,
does it? Two different issues is what, 750 lines in the budget? What, 10 of them maybe have to do with insurance?
402 lines.
400, whatever it is. It feels like 2,000 right now. The point is that not every line in this budget is
perfect.
Well, no, not every line. not every line in this budget has to do with insurance. And if we're doing the budget knowing that we're going to have insurance figures that are going to change,
right.
certainly we could do a default budget and review
with
that with the same notations. So I
mean, it's got to be the
know.
Same as last year's budget, default budget.
We've had this in the past. We've gotten the default budget from day one in the book right next to it,
right.
knowing that numbers would change. And before final review, we usually get those calculations, why we don't have it.
We haven't really reviewed and approved the municipal insurances yet. She came in and
like I said, those numbers are going to change, but right. they're going to change in the budget as well as the default budget.
Yeah.
So the rationale for not having a default budget right now
yeah.
to work with is moot point.
Well, it's the same thing with the undesignated fund balance. I mean,
right.
if the audit's finished, except for the Gadsby reconciliations,
it is,
fine, give us that portion that we can...
It is complete. But it has not been approved by the town, so that I won't push that one. But it should be wrapped up soon.
But you know, on the health, on the insurances business, where I have seen us underrun, even in the school, we overrun because they tell us, you know, budget like it won't be any greater than 6% or 7%
right.
or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so you budget for it, you crank your numbers in for it, and then 3 months later, you know, it comes out like you know half of what they.
They said it.
Half of what they said to me.
Like I said, if you know it's those lines are going to change, it still does not affect anything that is non-insurance related.
Right.
The rest
so
of the budget
you still have the other,
yeah.
let's say, 90% of the budget to be able to go over, knowing that those are changing. We're not, look, we know that. So I don't know why we don't have it. If there's anything you can do, Representative Bean, Selectman Bean.
I would suggest that you, as the chair, speak to the chairman of the Selectman Bean. That's what I would suggest.
I have done that already.
There you go.
Okay. But perhaps that was a couple of weeks ago. Perhaps you can instill a little bit more urgency at your next meeting on Monday that we're still looking for it. We realize the insurance numbers will change. They will change in the budget as well. We realize that. But the time really has come to give us the default budget.
Duly noted, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am.
I'll watch with eager anticipation.
Breathless anticipation.
So all right. We've kept you guys long tonight.
Would you like
no,
me to make
no,
a motion,
oh,
Madam
yes.
Chair?
No. You
what?
Deal with the treasurer question.
Oh, that's right.
What?
The treasurer question.
Oh.
Yes.
We all sent in questions we wanted to ask the treasurer to be centralized by the chairman
right.
for
right.
our... blessing or mashup tonight.
Okay.
So what's the question?
Remember?
And everybody got a copy?
Yes.
Yep.
I did not.
You did not?
Came in the email. I came today.
Came
yeah.
in an
yes,
email.
It did. I printed it.
So I sent you my question.
That was a pencil remarks. Did she answer the question with that? Yeah, well,
yes, I did
that.
That. Get
I saw
that copy.
That.
I apologize.
Oh, I saw that, but I didn't print it.
Can we have... I just got it, so I didn't read it.
So I was thinking that maybe I'd read it tonight when this meeting is done and I can go home and read it.
No, the one that she has her hand, I think, take a look at that. Is that the one that was sent out today?
It just came today. I did print what was in the email thing, but I haven't read it yet.
Yeah.
Because I'm here at this meeting, you know?
We're running, you know.
Yeah, we need to answer.
Take a look at it.
We need to ask more questions, that's for sure. Right, Jim?
I think at least
the response we got from the treasurer. We need to.
There were several things that arrived, and I haven't read any of them. It was something from the assessor.
We had one question out. I mean, I can read this to you.
Go ahead.
All right. Basically, the request itself. And I don't know if anybody else here had anything else they wanted to add. The questions right now seem to be centered around the Conservation Commission issue.
Right.
The other funds, there weren't any questions on. And basically, very clearly, what is the name or names of the funds? The request, put more simply, of the funds which the Conservation Commission is a stakeholder. What are the names of the funds? What is the current balance of each fund? What are the transaction details that have taken place in each fund during the year 2015?
Right.
What year was the warrant article passed in which each fund or funds was created or modified by the town meeting?
Amen.
Are we in agreement on these?
I only have one question.
That sounds pretty good.
And that is when we got a response back from her, a handwritten response, that she listed three accounts.
Yeah.
Is that three accounts under one fund or three
funds?
That's
what we're asking.
That's what we're asking.
Is that clear in that letter?
That's what we're going
to
ask.
When I spoke
to Ellen, know.
Clearly we needed the name of the funds, because if you go back to what started all of this, when the Conservation Commission came in, they started out saying they had one fund, then by the time we were done, it was two funds. The names of the funds had changed. There are going to be warrant articles out there with fund names on them,
and
what we got back was that sheet that had it broken down, but there still weren't any names to the funds.
Right.
With the names to the, where it's going is the names of the funds will give an identity to the fund that goes back and linked to a warrant article for purpose. I think if we're raising money at $90,000 a whack, $100,000 a whack, we need to know what fund that's going into. So,
well,
I think this question spells it out a little bit better. The question we had was whether we needed to take up her time and bring her in here, or if we get a satisfactory answer to this, then we don't have to do that.
So let's see what what the response is going to be.
I move that we
Tim, then Michael.
I think that what Eileen read off were essentially the four bullets of data that we're looking for.
Right.
This is from my memo. There was a contextual paragraph above that. Might clarify,
I can read that too, if you want me to.
That would be fine.
All right. There appears to be some confusion as to the Budget Committee's question. The Treasurer's response is attached, and that was the three items that you got, which was intended to remove confusion on the name of all funds, not the balance in each fund currently under the custodianship of the Town Treasurer and under the control of the Conservation Commission. To provide context to the confusion, we wish to clear up, and actually we've given a video snippet in their link to go back so she can look at what it is we have a question about. Thank you, Tim, for giving us that snippet. And Budget Committee meeting on 11/12. So we're giving her every opportunity to be very clear on what we want, short of taking up her time and coming in.
Yeah, if we fire those four bullets off, I think it'll work.
Now, we got that list of funds, Eileen.
Yeah.
That list of funds, which I don't have in my book, at home in another.
I'll send it.
The only one listed was Conservation Fund. That's
okay, so that would lead me to believe.
We don't want to be led to believe. We want to be factual.
All right.
That's all we want.
I can accept that.
So I would move, Madam Chair, that we request that this request that you just read be sent by the Chairman of the Budget Committee as an officer of the Budget Committee on behalf of the Budget Committee.
Keep the motion a little more
to
simple.
The Town Treasurer. Can I get a second?
I'll second it. I'll second it.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Can I make a motion?
Is that unanimous? Thank you.
A motion to adjourn?
Quick second.
Quick.
Wait a minute.
One quick question.
All right, go ahead.
Go ahead, quick.
Do you owe us warrant articles that have been sent to you? Are we one email behind? Because I heard Fred say that he had sent you the warrant articles that had been approved. And
you have what I have.
For the fire department.
You've got two batches of different dates.
You know, the one they did night before last or...
DPW.
Yeah, the last one.
Monday night.
Yeah,
I don't have those yet.
Okay, I thought he said that...
I don't have those yet.
I
will say that I've got... I keep asking for emails to go in one place, and they're always in someplace else. But I have been scrubbing both places, and I don't have those emails for Monday night, those warrant articles.
Madam Chair, may I request from Selectman Bean that it would be a great service to everyone in town if, as you pass the warrant articles in your selectmen's meeting, that you put them in a central place on the website?
Duly noted, sir.
And would you endeavor to make that happen?
Indeed, I will, sir.
Thank you very much. And that way, we have one central place to look at it.
Well,
we look forward to finding
it. What are you talking about putting them on the website?
The town has a website. If they put it on a central...
They're not finalized.
No. As they're approved.
Yeah, correct?
That's correct.
But they're approved, but still subject to be changed.
Well, we know that.
Well, they're all subject to be changed until like 7 days before.
I think Mr. Jones's point is well taken.
I have the vote total.
All right, if you have no problem with it, I have no problem. Okay. Just don't want people to be any...
Thank you, Selectman Bean.
I second that motion to adjourn.
All right, at 9:26, motion to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye. Thank you, General 22.
Thank you.